The board's been in executive session related to legal matters, which ended at 6:38. We'll get started this evening, regular meeting tonight with public comment. We have a couple of items to introduce. So first, Superintendent, I will turn it over to you for an introduction.
Great. We'd like to welcome the new principal of Maywood Middle School, and Sherry Cox, Executive Director of Middle Schools, will come and help pave the way for that introduction.
Good evening, Sherry Cox, Executive Director of Middle School Education, and I am just excited tonight to share with you a little bit about our newest our newest middle school principal, Erin Armstrong, is looking forward to serving the Maywood Middle School as a learning-focused, equity-driven, and highly collaborative principal. Erin has been an educator for 16 years, working with both middle and high school students in Los Angeles, Seattle, and Issaquah. She started teaching as a Teach for AmeriCorps member and discovered how much she loved building relationships with students and helping them see themselves as mathematicians. She received a master's in ed at UCLA and earned her national board certification in early adolescent mathematics. She completed her admin certificate through the Danforth Educational Leadership Program at the University of Washington and is currently our assistant principal at Liberty High School. She and her husband, Brendan, who's here with us tonight, live in the South End and have two children at Apollo and one child in preschool. And I believe you'll see them back there. She recognizes the opportunity to return to Maywood Middle School, where she taught math 7 years ago, is an incredible gift, and she is excited to welcome her oldest child to campus as an incoming sixth grader as well. She's grateful to Superintendent Taoyik and the school board to have this opportunity to serve the students, staff, and families of Maywood Middle School. Go Chargers.
Hi, I'm so honored to be here tonight, and it feels like just a moment ago that I was here 4 years ago, joining the Liberty High School staff as an assistant principal. But what I've been so fortunate with these last few years is to be following so many of my former students at Maywood as they've seen through their high school journey. And so a big piece of why I'm excited to return back to middle school is just knowing how critical that foundation is and really having a heart for that age and that particular time of life and transition. And so I really thank you for the opportunity. I was rewatching one of my favorite TED Talks today, Every Child Needs a Champion by Rita Pearson, and just really reflecting on what it's going to mean next year to have the opportunity to go back and be champions for the kids at Maywood Middle School. So just thank you so much. And I look forward to getting to communicate with you next year about all the great things happening in Maywood.
Congratulations. We like the handshakes. You can start with that one.
Oh, yeah.
And COVID. I just didn't note it. One thing I did forget to note is that we do have Director Meraldo. She is online with us this evening as well. So all members of the board are present this evening. Just one a little bit farther away than the others. Okay, next, I understand we have a couple of students with us who are going to come up. Tahina and Anaya. I got that right. And then we have online, we have Caitlin. Awesome. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Tahina Donna, and I am the current ASB president of Issaquah Middle School.
Hi, I'm Ananya, and I'm a part of the Heritage Club, and I help plan IMS's Heritage Fair for tomorrow.
Caitlin, you can introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Caitlin Garth-Green, and I'm our school secretary this year.
And we would like to invite the superintendent and the Issaquah School Board to IMS's first Global Heritage and Culture Fair in a very long time. This event will be a student-led and fun opportunity for the student body to learn more about the heritages of their peers and to increase a sense of community within the school.
Before this event was planned, our ASB president helped the Heritage Appreciation Club to help us plan the fair. In this club, we talked about how to make sure everyone's heritage has a chance to be represented. We planned fun activities such as passports for the students to travel around the world and raffle prizes for the students.
Caitlin, this is your time.
It's going to be our first global annual Citizen Heritage Fair on IMS, at IMS on April 28th at Friday from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. We worked with PTSA to put on this event together. We will have lots of things to do, from food trucks, mariachi bands, henna, hula dancers, and so much more. We would love to see everyone there. We also have a bunch of live performances.
Thank you so much for letting us be here, and we hope to see you at this event. This event is really important to IMS, especially this year, because after the pandemic, we haven't really had a chance to connect within the community. So we really hope to see you guys there.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. That's awesome. Wonderful. Okay, next we have an opportunity for a public comment. I do have a sign-up sheet from here in the room, and then after we go through the room, I will call on folks on Zoom. So first, I have, I believe it's Kate Antetadros, and apologies if I did not say that well.
That's close enough.
Like games, please correct me.
So it's Antetadros. Okay. Super close.
Awesome.
Okay, and the timer. All right. So my name is Kat. I am a counselor at one of our middle schools, and I'm also one of the GSA advisors. Cue the outfit. And I'm here to show my support for the queer students that are in our district. I don't know how many of you have worked with middle school kids directly, but the most common reaction I get from people when I tell others that I work in a middle school is normally a visual like cringe. Most people don't remember middle school very fondly. And if you're someone who does remember it fondly, I am very jealous of you, incredibly jealous, but that's a great thing. But part of the reason why it may be hard for us, or at least a lot of us whenever we were in school, is because of the social and social development and physical development craziness that's happening at that time. And socially, it can be really hard. Developmentally, our brains are still at a point where it's changing a lot, and we're trying to figure out who we are as a person. Now think about our queer students who are juggling all of that and trying to navigate being in queer spaces that may not be welcoming to them. Sometimes kids can be mean, and if they open TikTok or just really any news app, honestly, they see adults trying to tear them down as well. So having affirming spaces for them helps in more ways than I can express. But I want to thank the board for being supportive of our queer students with affirming policy. And thank you for allowing our schools the space so we can help all of our students feel welcomed and supported. So thank you.
Thank you for your input. I also realized I skipped my little normal intro, but you did beautifully on time. So this is public input. It's an opportunity for the board to receive public statements on items not listed on the meeting agenda for public comment. If you have a point of view or specific of a specific agenda item, I'll ask that you hold that until I request comments during that particular item. This public comment time is not intended as a time to raise issues unique to a particular student, staff member, administrator. Rather, it's a time to provide your insights on issues more generally and of a wider concern. As a general rule, the board will not respond to public comment. I ask that you begin your comments by clearly stating your name and school attendance area. Please limit your comments to 2 minutes. We will use a timer. The board neither endorses nor censors any opinions expressed during public input. Please keep all comments civil and respectful and avoid personal attacks on others. The audience should refrain from making comments or engaging in applause, but feel free to wave your hands in support of a speaker. So you did a great job of all of those rules without even me saying them. Next on the list, we have Sven Nader.
Good evening and welcome, Erin Armstrong. My wife, Wendy, Dr. Wendy Gure, was a middle school principal in California for years, so and I think middle school can be a really good place thing to remember. I'm Sven Nader, and Issaquah High School is the closest high school to me. The latest version of Flash Sexual Health curriculum, grades 4 through 6, include instruction about puberty blockers and encourages teachers to teach students to view gender in a non-binary concept. I quote, "Some people decide with the help of their doctor to take medicine or hormones to change puberty on purpose to better match their gender. They might take medicine that interferes with hormones, so puberty changes don't happen at all. Or they might take medicine made of hormones so that they have specific changes," end of quote. Here's one university's response to this. Quote, "I can't imagine how confused the child would be in that situation growing up. God has made the gender decision when the child is born, and they are either a boy or a girl. Once a child grows up and comes of age, they have a right. They have a right to decide if they're not comfortable in their gender," end of quote. And that is from Liberty University. I believe we might have one or two graduates from that school here. Let's let children be children. When they get older, they are very capable of making their own decisions on this. They're smarter than you think. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your input. If you could wave your hands and avoid the clapping, please. Next on the list is Josiah Morawski, if I'm saying that appropriately. Again, your name and attendance area, and then you have 2 minutes.
Yeah, as you said, my name is Josiah Morawski. So Issaquah School District is my local school district. I have a son who's 2 years old, so he's not yet attending, but this does affect him down the road. So on the topic of shared bathrooms and shared locker rooms for all gender fluidity situations, and I mean no offense if I inadvertently do, I apologize. I think that kids do have enough confusion going on in their lives at the moment, and enough pressure and societal grounds that are happening, that they can't make sense of a lot of it. And I think adding that in and putting that exposure on youth is inherently perverse, and it's unjust to do toward the influential minds that need to be focused on learning and not focused on their sexual identities. Thank you.
Thank you for your input. Again, waving, please. If we could keep that decorum, I would appreciate it. Last on the list, I have Samantha Sestasis.
Hi there, Samantha Sestasis, and we are in the Liberty Maywood area. And I was a middle school teacher for 14 years, 2 girls that went through Liberty High School. I do agree that all students should be safe and comfortable, but shared bathrooms actually don't do that. One person may think that that's comfortable, but the others that are involved may feel very, very uncomfortable. And if you remember being in middle school bathrooms, a lot happens in there. And so I think we're setting up kids for a lot of issues. There's no surveillance in there, no chaperones in there, obviously, for good reason. But this is just not really a great situation. It's a place of vulnerability, need privacy. If we need to go to all individual bathrooms to address the situation, maybe we need to, but the shared bathrooms is not a good idea. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you for your input. Stephen, do we have anyone online? No? Okay. Okay, thank you. On behalf of the board, I'd like to thank each of you for attending our meeting and sharing your point of view. The board appreciates the comments made at our meetings and through email. We're not able to respond to your comments in the moment of the meeting, but rest assured that we've heard your voices and we'll take your comments into consideration. Next on the agenda, we have the approval of the consent agenda.
I move the consent agenda be approved as presented.
Second.
Thank you. The consent agenda is a meeting management tool whereby the board is able to pass multiple items in one motion. The consent agenda items have been reviewed by the board prior to this meeting. We have our motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you, Marnie. Any against? No. Okay, consent agenda passes. Okay, we are now at the establishment of the regular agenda. Superintendent, are there any changes to the regular agenda?
There are no changes.
Okay, thank you for that. Wonderful. So the first item on our regular agenda is a review of our work study. So the board had a work study prior to the start of this meeting, and it was focused on our EL12 learning environment. And so this is our opportunity for the board to share any learnings or insights from that session. Who would like to get us started?
First off, I appreciate the fact that we brought in some other people to that work study. It was really helpful to hear from students on their perceptions of how things were going in the schools and what was clear to them and what wasn't, as well as the Liberty teacher made some very interesting, thought-provoking comments. I was impressed at the amount of work that's been done out in the field in terms of looking at some of the issues on EL12, figuring out where teachers and departments and courses align and where they don't. It still got a little smushy when we were talking about, well, these are just suggestions and teachers are kind of going to do it their way. And so I appreciated President Mulling's comments about, well, can't we have like a minimum standard? So I learned a lot. It was very interesting. There's still some itches that aren't being scratched, but I think we're making some really good progress. And I do appreciate all the work that people are doing to try to get the district into alignment with the EL12.
Right. I would I like the intentionality of having a structure to have the departments work through and think through. I know, you know, we were you were sharing the toolkit, which is a framework. So I appreciate that consistency of which all the teachers and groups should be looking at it, because they'll also have common words and ideas behind where we're trying to go by having that framework. I did too think it was super helpful to hear from teacher and students and their perspective in their experiences and where they're going. Yeah, it does still sound like there's maybe more variability than we would want, but I think that the work is still continuing to try to get us to that consistency.
I really appreciated having students and teacher and counselors and principals there. And, you know, I think part of our reboot post-COVID is we just haven't gotten back into our cycle of just having work studies to focus on our policy work. And I think we need to do that. And as we do that, it should be and I know that now that we have 8 students, we can make sure we have students at everyone. But the power of having teacher voice there was really, really helpful. So I think that we need to have policy work studies at every meeting we possibly can, because that way we can have student and teacher voice at. And then I would request that for the next one, that we really shrink the amount of time for framing and expand the time for dialogue, because I don't think we need to go through exercise necessarily, because the intent of the board is to talk about policy and impact of policy. The tools that exist or are created is really less relevant to me, because that is purely operational. Sending out and having me look at it, sure. but the power of that time, because it goes so quickly, is to hear dialogue and to hear the perspective of my colleagues as well as of teachers and students. And that's what I think the intent of work studies is, to maximize that informal discussion time to be able to do, not to necessarily go through an exercise. So I appreciate the work that's been done by the district on EL12. And I just want to continue to reiterate, just because I don't think anyone of us has said it yet, our intention with EL12 is for us to have students have the opportunity to demonstrate mastery and to have alignment across our district so that every student in every school has the same opportunity to do that. And while that sounds easy, or having a minimum standard of getting to that, we've learned in changing policy into practice is actually quite difficult. And I appreciate all the work that the superintendent and her team have and continue to do on that.
Director Moraldo, did you want to add anything? I know you were remote.
Yeah. So I think one of the things that I was thinking through as listening is that we do need to have more time to really converse about what do we mean when we say we want students to be able to demonstrate mastery. And I think it goes along with a homework discussion. What is homework? What are the standards in that class that homework assignment is trying to ensure that the student understands and has learned? And then how are you measuring that? And how many opportunities does a student have to display that they have mastery of that content, or to what extent? And so maybe it's that students have multiple opportunities to show mastery, but what they show is what level of mastery they have. You know, how far have they, you know, how far have they gotten through that standard? And do they have an opportunity to grow? And then we can have a whole conversation around grades, which, you know, my philosophy on grades is grades should be communication, but currently they're currency. And so how do we get to the point where the grade is a communication to the student of what level they've reached towards mastery? That's really what it should be. But we have this whole education system that's built around my grade is my currency that I spend at the college of my choice. And so how do we get back to what Director Gallinger was talking about during the work study, which is how do we make sure that this is about learning and not about grades? Because our whole point is we want students to be learning. And our conversation around the grades is that we are concerned that students are missing the learning piece just to get to the grade piece. And so that's the dialogue I want to be having with some of our key teachers. What's that discussion? Because Executive Director Zier talked about, you know, we think we're aligned on our beliefs and our vision, but are we? I don't know that for sure. And even after this conversation, I don't know that I know that. Certainly the ones that come to the table and say, I'm interested in this topic and I want to talk about it are definitely. But when I looked at that spreadsheet, there were a lot of places that said, no, we're not aligned yet, or no, we're not, you know, we're somewhat aligned, which means, no, we haven't really everybody bought into the same belief around what are we trying to do as a school system, educate students and ensure that these are the standards of their learning and that they are mastering those standards is our hope, is that every student masters everything. Now, no, not everybody's perfect at everything, so I don't know that we'll get there. But I think those are the conversations that I'm still interested in having.
Thank you. I think for me, maybe my biggest takeaway, Director Gallinger mentioned, which is it just really felt good to be having that as the conversation versus a lot of other things in the last couple of years. And it was also really great to be able to hear all of the effort that's underway, all the steps that's being taken. And for me, that was great. That was great to understand, this is work that's known, that we want to make sure we're aligning our approaches so students have a consistent experience, that people are really, I guess, wrestling with that and wanting to make sure we're getting to the best possible environment for our students. So for me, that was, you know, A plus in the conversation. I think I also, excuse me, have a better sense of where are we now? And I think our future conversations will help me with where are we going when, for sure. But I think it's really important to do that work. And it's even great, you know, to understand that there's a tool that folks will help get them aligned, for sure. So I was super appreciative. Again, I probably oversimplify things with my, is there just a minimum standard approach that is okay to go with, and really ask that with all curiosity, not with any sort of judgment. So I appreciate the entertainment of my, what may feel like rudimentary questions as well. Superintendent, anything you'd like to add?
Just want to add, I love the discussion, being able to hear and also hear directly from teachers and students and team members in schools around what their interpretation is and how they're thinking about learning. And the one other note that did come out was the fact that this is also about not only about learning and mastery, but also reducing stress. And I think that was sort of embedded in all the comments that I heard just now, but was explicitly shared and has been explicitly shared actually throughout our strategic planning process, that our students feel do feel stressed out. And this is one way to alleviate that and try and address that as well. So huge thank you to our counselors and teachers and students and principal who did attend, and to Andrea Zier, Executive Director of High Schools, for facilitating and setting us up for that conversation.
And we will have our next conversation, our next work study, May 11th, so to continue that conversation. So looking forward to the next one. So next on our agenda is the board has had a couple of opportunities to gather together, to have professional development learning opportunities as a board. I am deeply sad that I could not attend either one. It's been incredibly stressful and hectic in my day job as of late, and I felt good to be missed. So I'm really excited to hear about these next couple of topics, and we could start off with the NSBA conference that that occurred. So who'd like to get us started on that discussion?
I feel like I always start, but I'll start. This was actually one of the better NSBAs that I've been to, in terms of, you know, you have seven opportunities for training and there's usually always one that's just kind of a dud. And that wasn't really true this time. So I felt really good about that. And I went to a lot of interesting sessions. I did a legal update, which is always fascinating. But what I tried to focus on the most, because it's in our future, was things about high schools and about careers and about, you know, how do we get kids through high school and into that career? And it's not necessarily college. And one session that I went to was called Innovation That Is Leading the Way in Transformational Learning. And they had people from schools in Denver, Missouri, and Michigan that were all kind of like Gibson Eck on steroids. And it was just fascinating. I took massive amounts of notes. They have all kinds of industry partnerships. They went out in their communities. They figured out what are the jobs, what could we train kids to do? The companies worked with them, sometimes providing funding, you know, helping them to design basically maker spaces so that the high schools could train the kids to be employees of the local companies. And three different schools. So that was fascinating. One of the most interesting statistics I heard, and I heard it in two different classes, so I'm going to say it, is out of 10 jobs that are sort of out there, one job requires a master's, two jobs require a bachelor's, and the other six, but that only adds up to nine. So obviously my note-taking has some issues. Less than 4 years of college. So to the extent that, you know, we're still focused on, wow, every student has to go do 4 years of college, which I think we're not as focused on as we used to be. That is definitely not the job market that we're seeing in a lot of places. So some fascinating stuff about high schools, about CTE, about working with the business community. And then I'm just going to add one other thing, which was the third keynote speaker. I'm really sorry that he was the third, because half the people go home on Monday, was the guy who invented Siri when Siri was an app. Mm-hmm. And he talked a lot about artificial intelligence and ChatGPT and how that was changing the landscape of education, which was just a really good segue into the second conference that we're going to talk about in a few minutes.
Yes, it was a good conference. I went to a number of good sessions. One of the ones that I went to that really resonated with me was this. It was actually titled something about fear of failure, that, you know, too many kids become paralyzed with this fear of failure over their work. And it was really expressing the notion that, you know, either to be, it's not a binary, you're successful or you're a failure. And success really isn't a destination. It's all a process to get there. And the idea that you struggle through failure to get to success, and you cycle through that. And so, you know, it was really, you know, it kind of ties in with our social emotional learning, that kids have to learn that resilience of being able to reach success through struggles and failures. So that was really interesting. Went to the law one. I think Suzanne and I both did, and there were several interesting things. Talked about the Kennedy versus Bremerton lawsuit that went all the way to the Supreme Court. It was very interesting because we had the principal from the actual high school was in the session, and it gave us some more insight into the real experience of what was happening versus kind of the narrative that came out of the Supreme Court ruling. And then I also really enjoyed the speaker we had, the second day, Jenna Bush Hager. She herself was a teacher, and she was very inspiring as far as her connection to her students and her passion for teaching. And it just resonates because I know we have a lot of teachers just like her in our school system that care very deeply about our students and their success in our schools. And then, yes, the fella that was the founder or the creator of Siri was very interesting and, you know, started us on that, the notion that, you know, the ChatGPT and AI, these things are here and schools really have to figure out a way to work with it instead of trying to ban it and close the door and keep it out, that they can be tools to help our students learn. But we also have to help our students understand that their struggles through their work, kind of back to my, you know, earlier part, are a part of what they learn when they come out the other end. And it helps them with their critical thinking versus having an AI bot do all their work for them, right? It's not going to help them in the end. So those are the few I want.
I sent the three handouts to the board while I was listening to you guys of the three I wanted to talk about. The first one was a session on youth mental health. But what I thought was really unique about it was talking about the parent aspect, because so often parents feel helpless when their child is struggling, much less in crisis. And one of the unique things of their approach is they really felt that tier one intervention is parent coaching and parent agency. And so they have that exists free to all parents all over the country right now. And it's called parentguidance.org. They actually encourage school districts to put the QR code actually on their website and to link those resources. More importantly, then the school district can sign up to be part of a mental health series, so like a monthly dialogue for very little cost. And then their tier three intervention is for parents to be able to access a parent coach. And why they call it a parent coach is because as a company that's based in Utah to offer healthcare services across state lines, the regulatory limitation to that is, and that bar is so high and so cumbersome, but parent coaching is allowed. And truly it's essentially like family counseling for how do I help my child in crisis? But it paired so nicely with all of the work that we're doing from a PBSES, and it really loops in the home part, which I think that's been probably the piece that we have missed the most. Because when I think about all of our investments in youth mental health, it's really been tier three interventions with having the mental health counselors. That's kind of like you refer to them. Tier two would be our counselors, but we don't really have a lot of just tier one beyond. Oh yes, we do STQ and we do BZ, but that doesn't really scratch the itch of like, how do you just help equip and empower me feeling like a helpless high school parent now with a freshman? It would just be really helpful because there are not things that you are prepared for as a parent, and to be able to access these and asynchronously access, be like, hey, look, there's this session on, you know, how to help my student focus. And you can just do that. So why I like NSBA is because, as well as with WASDA, and it's not that I didn't like ASU, GSV, but you can walk away with things like, hey, this is things that our districts and our similar demographics that are doing, that are working for, and this was Jackson Hole, Wyoming, was the district that presented on this and really helped and touted how it's helped and how low cost it is. And that's the key part too. So that's something I would love to see our district pivot on quickly, because all of our parents, I think, desire to be the best parents we can be. And I, this helps us with that. So that's the first one. The second one was, and I think I went to this one with Director Moore. And this was, again, from similar demographic school in suburban Wisconsin. And what I thought this one stood out for me, and they call theirs is the Insight Program, but it's really a career-connected learning. And but it's embedded within their comprehensive high school. And for me, I thought, when this board established Gibson Eck, the desire was, hey, Gibson Eck would be this innovation space that we hope would cascade throughout our district. And for various reasons, it probably hasn't to the degree that we would ideally like to see. And it's hard, like, how do you take that sort of learning style of Gibson Eck, and we can't translate that to a 2,500 person high school. But this would be a vehicle by which you really could, in how they approach it, and took that part and put it, embedded it within their traditional school day and the number of partnerships they had with like every college in the state was really impressive, as well as, hey, we wanted, the whole point of this is we want students to walk away with high school. We want every student to walk away with college credits or certification by the time they graduate high school. And we want them to have a mentor if they so choose, and that this is the focus way that they can nibble on these various different career pathways to see what ones they may like or not like. Because their point was, if you go through and you think you're going to be a social worker, but you don't get to do those social worker type classes to your third or fourth year of college, and then you get there and realize like, this isn't actually what I want to do with my life. Well, now you've not as optimized the use of your last 2 years of high school and your first 2 years of college, and you wanted to be a writer or something. So I thought that was just really, for the first time, to get to see like, oh, well, this is a way that we could truly embed CTE and career connected learning and mentoring, which I think is the hallmark of Gibson Eck, in a way that is bite-sized and meaningful for our comprehensive high schools. So I thought that was really powerful. And then the third one was the Spanish dual immersion program, which was ours is modeled off of in this whole state of Delaware. And it's unique because the state has mandated that all school districts will offer dual language. This district has particularly chosen Spanish, and it talks about their ramp up from just two schools to all their elementary schools. And it was, so they actively recruit teachers throughout the world, and how they do that and how they help with visas. And because they knew that they couldn't do it just locally and they couldn't sustain that locally, but how that has enriched the culture of learning. It's not just about the language that students are learning, but also the culture piece really enriched that. So I thought that was a really helpful, useful thing to see another way district, because I know our district has also struggled with recruitment and retention. And so I was surprised and intrigued with how they were recruiting.
It's fantastic. Director Meraldo.
Yeah, as your delegate to the NSBA Board of Directors, I had most of my time was doing that work. I think I attended one session with Director Weaver, where it was an equity, and it was a kind of a discussion. And I think really for the work that we've done with equity, it was kind of I was hoping to get more out of it than I think it was more of a first level discussion around equity in schools. So, but I was really, I think the most fascinating point of the conference for me was Adam Schreyer, who was the third speaker that was talked about. And he's planning on working with the board of directors at NSBA. And I don't know exactly how, but I think that we need to have a broader conversation around artificial intelligence and education. And so I'm hoping that with his support, we can that NSBA can kind of get on the ball and get there, because this is all happening before our eyes and we need to have the discussion now and not 5 years from now.
You know, I may know someone if you need help, you know, let me know. And then you and I both met any, so thank you. I loved getting to hear about that and going through some of the sessions. Unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to be there. So I appreciate that. The next topic is about the following learning and professional development opportunity for the board, which is the ASU plus GSV summit. So I'd love to hear about that one as well.
This is our superintendent.
Do you want to start or do you want to end? Okay. Sure. Yeah,
all right, it's me. this one was really interesting, and I have to thank our superintendent for finding a way to get us to attend this. It was, as Director Gallinger said, very different from NSBA in that NSBA and WASDA are both, our district had this problem, and this is how we chose to deal with the problem. And maybe you can take our experience and deal with your problem. It's very much set up that way, and it's very helpful. It's very useful. The ASU GSV Summit, every single session I went to, so I thought it was all of them, but Director Moore corrected me that she went to some that were not. But everyone that I went to was set up like a fireside chat, minus the fire. So they had two or three or five experts on something just sitting on the stage chatting. And they didn't really give you answers, but they provoked a ton of questions. And it was really very, very thoughtful. The speakers that came in, I don't even want to call them keynotes, because again, it was just sort of fireside chat type things. But they had some fabulous speakers, one of whom I've got on my phone. This one, I also tried to do some classes that tended to focus on, again, I had the new high school in my head. And so a couple that focused on career exploration, they talked a lot about how we should really be exposing our kids to career opportunities in middle school and maybe even elementary school, which I thought was really interesting because we tend to think of that more as a high school thing. But, you know, as Director Gallinger said, you want to get exposed to things early so that, you know, you try a little something and you go, oh yeah, no, I don't think I want to be that person. And it's good to know that sooner rather than later. So a couple of those things, a couple of talks about workforce readiness and things that we can do in the high schools, not unlike NSBA. And then I veered off into the fascinating world of artificial intelligence. And there were a lot of speakers talking about artificial intelligence, talking about the ethics of it, the integrity of it. Is it good? Is it bad? And the general consensus is it may be good, it may be bad. We're still having some problems with it. But the answer is not to say, hey, kids, don't use this, because that's going to be an epic fail. And so we need to figure out, okay, how can this be a tool as opposed to a way to cheat, which no one wants that. But what it impressed upon me more than anything is this is happening. This is happening fast. A lot of our adults in the room don't know anything about it. I have to say, up until about a month ago, I didn't know anything about it. But our kids know everything about it because our kids are smart. And that's not necessarily a really good dynamic to have in a school where the kids know all the stuff and the educators don't. So I think it's something that we are going to have to provide our educators support around. I think we're going to have to do it sooner rather than later. We always think of public education as the giant ship that turns very slowly, and we have to think everything through and make sure we don't have any unintended consequences. And we probably don't have the luxury to do that with AI and ChatGPT because it is happening so fast and so furious. And it's almost like the whole technological piece of it is getting ahead of the people who actually write it, which is a little hard to wrap your head around, but that's what I was getting. Really, really fascinating. Just tons of food for thought. Oh, I just looked, another one I went to, will U.S. students recover from pandemic learning losses? I mean, they covered all kinds of fascinating topics. And I will just say there were more fabulous speakers than I could shake a stick at, but the one that really stood out to me, and I'm probably going to steal Harlan's thunder because I know he really liked him too, was a gentleman named, and I'm going to mangle his name, Freeman Hrabowski. Mm-hmm. He's a professor emeritus from the University of Maryland, Baltimore. I don't know what the C stands for.
Baltimore County.
County. Thank you.
UNBC.
But he's originally from Alabama, and he was talking about just empowering children to believe in themselves. And the questions around his family dining table weren't, how was school? They were, what did you learn today? Did you ask good questions? What questions did you ask? And just talked about being passionate about making a difference. He was such a motivational speaker. I mean, I just walked away feeling good about kids and good about everything. He was amazing. So I could talk for another 20 minutes, but I won't. I'll let somebody else go.
Well, I agree. It was a really good conference. And I do appreciate, Superintendent, that you were able to get us scholarships for our attendance. For both the conference itself and for our hotel. So that was greatly appreciated that you were able to do that. As Suzanne said, it was a very different conference compared to the ones we've been to, but it was also very enlightening because it was definitely things that made you really think further out than we're accustomed to. I also went to a number of the AI sessions. And there was a great deal of discussion about this is going to take away hundreds of thousands of jobs to this is going to empower the humans that do jobs to do better work with their jobs because they have the opportunity to use ChatGPT AI type technology. As it delved into, how is this really going to work in schools? With students, it's something that they're not going to be able to keep out. So you need to figure out how to bring it into the classroom and use it as a tool and help students know how to use it, when to cite that they're using it, because that will be important to understand the limitations of it. Because as we learned the phrase that ChatGPT hallucinates, which means it sort of makes things up, and students need to, for the use of it, oh, that's how they phrase it. That the students' use of it means the students are accountable for the accuracy of whatever they then turn in. So if they've used it, ChatGPT could be wrong. And so when they turn it in, they're wrong because they need to be accountable for what they turn in. It was interesting. I think Harlan went to one of the sessions I did as well that had Saul Kahn from Khan Academy and the work they're doing to integrate it into Khan Academy. But it creates almost like a tutor helping a student right along the way. So it could have great value because you went to a session where it was like, oh, the solution is like a tutor or an adult for every four students while they work, yeah. Right? Like where will we ever both either afford or find the people to do that? But if students can have a more right on the, when they need it, tutor helping them through something like a ChatGPT type bot could be very valuable. And they've set it up so that, the student does, answers a math problem and then the bot helps them. I see you've done something. This part's good, but have you considered this or that? So it doesn't just turn around and give them the answer, but kind of walks them through how can I get to the solution to this problem? So I think it's something that, as you said, is coming on really fast that we need to figure out how to adapt to.
I also went to some of the sessions on career exploration. There was a lot around helping young people to test and try to explore careers early. Because what you, when you, you learn you don't like something, that's just as valuable as learning you do like something. And so the earlier they can do this, the better. And I think there were excellent speakers. I really enjoyed, what's the woman's name? Cheryl Stanberg, yeah, who spoke. And that was very a good opportunity to hear her speak, along with the others. So it was a really good conference.
Yeah, I want to say one other thing about the AI, because, and I think this was also Sal Khan. So he is using ChatGPT in his academy stuff. So I think what he was talking about was not something that's readily available on the internet, but something that he's building. But he used as an example, this little girl was reading The Great Gatsby and wondering what's the deal with the green light. And so she just goes on and starts a conversation with Mr. Gatsby. Why are you looking at the green light? And he starts telling her. And Sal Khan goes on to say how amazing this was, that she had a 2-hour conversation with Mr. Gatsby. And at the end says, "Oh, thank you so much. I'm sorry to have taken up so much of your time." He thought that was great. I saw that as a real opportunity to like totally disconnect with reality in a strange mental health way. So it's just another, in addition to the whole problem with hallucinating, there are some real dangers to this. I mean, maybe that's an amazing experience, or maybe somebody's just spent 2 hours communicating with someone who doesn't exist. So there's a lot to think.
Well, there is a lot there. And where I thought you were going to go is also where Sal Khan was talking about it with his Khan Academy, is there would be the ChatGPT type thing is really in the background. And then there was another AI bot monitoring the conversation between the chat bot in the back with the student. And, so they were trying to ensure there were guardrails around the system for his system, so that young people are protected, because again, ChatGPT hallucinates. I mean, I went home after being at this and signed up for ChatGPT and have had some conversations. And right off the bat, the first several things I was inquiring about, it gave me wrong information and I knew the answer and it was wrong. But yet that's what it gave it to me, very, very, as if it were absolute.
It's very certain.
It is.
So I appreciated what everything, what people have said. And so I signed up to participate in the pilot for Khan Academy. And so you have to, I guess Khan Academy is free, but for this part, it's $20 a month donation. So I got notified today that I'm off the wait list, so I can start donating and access that piece of it. That I thought would be interesting just to try. I don't even know what Khan Academy is. But one of the sessions I went to was particularly focused on education technology for special education. And I really was impressed with that space. And one of the things they really talked about is how can you leverage technology to do, so teachers don't have to do more with less, which is what we keep asking them to do, certainly post-pandemic, but to really do less with more and to really leverage technology to do that. So it was inspiring to hear about the different opportunities for that. And I think that there's so many ways that we can better serve our teachers and better serve our students and families. And the more we can leverage technology so we can address teacher burnout and being able to still provide the education interventions that exist. And I think technology will help us to be able to do earlier identification, to leverage more supports for our students who are struggling early readers. And so I left with hope. even though I've, as I move and my world moves to the high school space, I still don't want to lose sight of those foundational things that we have to get right as a school system, not just for our district, but statewide. But I thought that was a really important thing. So I'll keep you posted on this whole Khan Academy integration with ChatGPT and see how that goes from a tutoring standpoint. I presented to the Issaquah Special Education PTSA on Monday and asked them to also do this, because what I think I had a side conversation after that session with the chief learning officer for Khan Academy and asked specifically, like, hey, as you built this tutorial, did you do anything with it for the lens through struggling readers or dyslexia or special education? They said no. So I thought what we could do is a community, this is where we should help them say, like, hey, here's how it's working or not working for our students. Because I think that's a benefit of this happening so fast, is they're in that early phase and they really want to get that feedback on this is or isn't working. And I hope they put enough safeguards to be able to identify the hallucinations, to your point. Because I think that's the worry, is we don't want our students taking it as truth. And our youngest learner certainly will not be versed in disinformation screening. I'm not even sure when we're taught that anywhere in our system, but I'm sure we are at certain grade levels. But I think that will just be something that we're going to have to probably reinforce throughout. But for me, I think I left thinking we need to have like a director of AI integration at our district, because it's going to be having to talk through the adults to what Director Weaver said, so they're not fearful of this, because our students are already going to be, they're already long down this road. And this is going to be integrated with every field of work that exists. And it's, how do you leverage this? Not how does it take over your job?
Director Miranda?
Yeah, so much has been said so far, so I'll try to see if I can figure out something that hadn't. The first thing that comes to mind is I did appreciate that some of a senior staff was also there, senior administrative staff, and being able to talk to them about what we were hearing. I appreciated that just that opportunity to hear Executive Director Mullish talk about what they're doing in teaching and learning, how he already has integrated using ChatGPT into his own work. Because I think it is something about how do you utilize it as a tool. I thought that my biggest takeaway is I felt like this was talking more and more and more about what I've always talked about, which is, rather than it being teaching, it's facilitating learning. So if you're teaching something, it's about, are you operating in the right pedagogy? Did you put together a lesson plan? How did that lesson plan go as far as presenting the lesson plan? And then the learning's up to the student. Whereas if the shift is on facilitating learning, then that position it becomes about, what are the tools that I can find to ensure that the student is learning and then ultimately mastering the content? But how do I get to that point, that higher level work with the student? Because really, I mean, it is not, you could probably ask ChatGPT to write your lesson plan, and you would have to do very little editing of it. I mean, you're really using the AI as a tool, much to what Harlan was talking about, so that the instructor, that your job then becomes facilitating learning and not doing all of these other pieces. And I think Sal Khan was even talking about, in some of the instances, even if it's an essay, the student can be writing the essay and what he calls it Khan Amigo. Or Khanmigo, I think is what it's called, but that the student can be writing that, and that Khan Academy can then send back to the teacher an analysis of how the student's done. So if a student suddenly writes a, you know, 500 word essay in 2 seconds, well, clearly they did a copy paste, and it can tell them that. So if it's using AI somewhere else to try to generate its essay, and so that it's more about, so on the teacher side, it's more about how do you use it as a tool? And on the student side, how do you use it to help facilitate your learning? So that, excuse me, my coughing is why I'm here and not there. So how do you get to the point where you're learning the information and doing the iterations? And so much of using AI is about how do I use it to iterate to get to a better version of what I'm about to do? And I'm about to have a coughing fit. I've been waiting this whole time and now I'm going to cough about it. But I think there's a lot of conversations that we have to have.
Thank you. There she goes. Superintendent.
I want to say thank you. It's just helpful to be able to hear everyone's reflections because that will help our team and our teaching and our support team members know how to also wrestle with some of these questions and get exposure to the content. So I do want to say, you know, this was a unique opportunity. We did receive 10 scholarships to not only defray the cost and fully sponsor us for the registration fee and 4 nights of lodging and all of our meals. We just got access to an incredible amount of learning and cutting edge kind of concepts from the nascent sort of ideation that where educators and board members could actually inform that development in the future, but also just people who are very far ahead in the development of AI and that use. And actually the thing I picked up on was it's not actually ChatGPT because the next version is GPT-4. So we're even behind now in our lexicon or language of how we're referring to that particular tool. I think the marketing as sort of the concept and the theme of the conference for the ASU-GSV Summit was Brave New World, and you can't use an old map for a new world. And I think that's just a really helpful distillation of how we can move forward together and collectively overall. And I, again, appreciate ASU-GSV for that sponsorship effort. One of my thoughts, just to echo what was being said, is this really the AI work and GPT-4 for us really has several implications, you know, how we teach, what we teach, and how to do it safely and ethically. The risk really is to not do anything or to not move fast enough, given those really critical questions. And there's a level of analysis that is a really critical opportunity now for both our students and our own staff to be able to say, hey, what does this imply, right, for our teaching? What does this imply for the workforce? If I want to become a journalist, is my value going to be in writing obituaries? Or, sorry, that's a morbid kind of reference, but is my value going to be reporting on something that actually could be reported through GPT-4 or the next version? And actually my role becomes actually monitoring that. Is it factually correct? Can I add the humanity and creativity to that? That gives it a different flair as well. So it does mean that reading becomes even more important because you have to be able to distill that information, interpret it, and then analyze it to know whether it's correct and critically think. So there's a level of analysis that we're at a really unique opportunity to be able to engage with our students and our team members on where is their value? How do we leverage it? What does it mean we do differently for all the reasons of teaching and what we teach and how to do it safely and ethically? So those are my big takeaways. And I appreciated being with both team members and cabinet team members and the board and being able to have that learning together and be able to make sense of that moving forward. So thank you for taking the time to attend and engage. I really think that was meaningful and appreciated.
Thank you. Great conversation. And I'm really sad I missed that one because you all are talking about the world I live in every day. So I have a lot to say on all those topics. I won't belabor that tonight. But what we can do is move to the next agenda item, which is works in progress for you, Superintendent.
All right, great. So I just want to acknowledge that we had a great Issaquah Schools Foundation Nourish Every Mind event with over 500 attendees. Very huge appreciation for the board president, Tricia Marshall, and the staff and the Issaquah Schools Foundation board. The highlight for me was not only seeing so many people engaged in education, also the highlights of our students and the programs that the Issaquah Schools Foundation is supporting. But we had great student speakers from Issaquah High School, Newcastle, and Apollo, and we also heard from an alumna from Issaquah High School as well. So that was pretty amazing. I'd also like to congratulate the new slate of PTS leadership that was voted at the general member at the meeting today. So first, thank you to Lauren Bartholomew for her work and partnership as the current president. And then she actually will be the vice president elect. Aaron Eaton is the president elect. And then for treasurer, Nikki Mason. Office of VP of Secondary is Carissa Mobilia. Elementary North is Tracy Jones, and Elementary South is Christy Hammond. So congratulations to that team of leaders who are going to be stepping into their roles this summer. I also wanted to share an update on Issaquah High School Stadium. That has been a topic of several emails and outreach to the board, as well as for public comment. And we did a presentation earlier in a prior meeting just on those updates for stadium details. And I want to appreciate and thank Tom Mullins and Martin Turney for conducting a meeting April 19th that had approximately 11 community members attending and several employees. And the purpose of this listening session was really to have district leadership get together with and listen to the Issaquah High School boosters and community members related to their concerns around various topics. Specifically, concerns were raised and continue to be discussed around lighting. And Martin and Tom committed to investigating this lighting replacement cost and to get back to the group with further information. And we are already underway with that. And that does take also partnership with the city of Issaquah. So that's begun and is underway. The topic of stadium capacity was also discussed and raised. And as a reminder, we did talk about that in our March 9th board meeting discussion and presentation on this, but we are limited by the land use code with constraints, which constrains our ability to expand that seating significantly. So it's just, we have to reground ourselves in some of the constraints to remind ourselves why and why not we are able to expand in a significant way the seating. And then the track condition was another topic that was discussed, and we're moving forward with that. This timeline is estimated now for completion this summer. So just some follow-up on the Issaquah High School stadium concerns and the work that's underway. And Tom and Martin will be in continued conversation with this group, as well as navigating and shepherding those projects moving forward. That's an update there. And then lastly, I wanted to share that the special services team is excited to announce that they're launching both a student advisory and parent guardian advisory group in the fall of 2023. And both of these groups, in addition to existing staff advisory groups, are really focused on ensuring the voice and representation of the various vested partners to provide input into special service executive team members regarding programs, practices, and services, with a focus on improving outcomes for our students who are receiving special education services in the district. And thank you to Cabinet Leader and Executive Director of Special Services, Shereen Carver, for leading that work in conversation and launching that work and preparing to launch that work to go even deeper in partnership with our families. And then finally, I have some news about the executive assistant to the superintendent and the transition here. And so I look to Diane because she's currently in that seat. But I am excited, and we are excited to share the news that Bethany Rogers will be stepping in officially to the role this summer and overlap her transition with Diane, who we are deeply grateful for. And we will spend a lot more time appreciating and acknowledging Diane in the future. Bethany brings extensive experience in our district and currently serves as the administrative assistant for elementary education. She has knowledge of our district that's deep, a commitment to our community, and a strong skill set in customer service, organization and planning, and team support. So Diane, Bethany, Susan Mundell, and Melinda Reinvan, and I will be seamless in our coordination and our planning. And we'd like to welcome Bethany formally to this team to support also the board work. And I will also just say thank you to Director Marnie Moraldo for serving on interviews with me at the final stages. So much appreciation. And with that, back to you.
Thank you. the next item on our agenda, I guess I can't blame Marmy, she didn't come in. The next item on our agenda is a topic update of Student Board Representative Program, which is GP12. So Director Weaver, I know you shared an update on your revisions to that GP. And so maybe I'll hand it to you to work through.
Okay, so first thing I have to do is apologize for this. This was supposed to be the second read, and I was supposed to make a motion to approve it. And because the changes I'm proposing are not what's actually attached to the agenda. And because they are different than what we discussed, I'm thinking that this is actually the first read. And the reason that that happened is not just that I'm flighty and capricious, but Director Meraldo and I had a meeting with Andrea Zier and Marcel and the superintendent to talk about the whole program. And ostensibly, we were going to select the students for interviews, which we ultimately did. But as we talked about how it needed to work and what made sense, it just became increasingly apparent that what we really want is the staggered 2-year term. We want a group of seniors who were in place last year, which obviously with the exception of Liberty, we don't have that. But ideally we want a group of seniors who are experienced and a group of sophomores or juniors who are new and can learn from the experienced members. And then as the experienced members transition out, the newbies become the old bees and mentor the next batch. So what that means practically, we're a little out of sync with what I'm proposing here, because practically we do have 2 student reps from Liberty who are currently underclassmen. So I believe we're going to try to prevail on at least one of them to stick around and be a mentor. So our thought was we bring in 1 underclassman from Liberty, an underclassman from each of Skyline, Gibson Eck, and Issaquah, and a senior from each of Skyline, Issaquah, and Liberty, and Gibson Eck, excuse me. And that will only have 1 experienced person this go around, but this time next year, we will be in full sync of the staggered 2-year term. And this is all contingent upon the fact that when we interview those underclassmen, we say, you know, you're signing up for 2 years, right? And they nod. So we'll see. So that's all a preamble to why what I sent you in an email is not what's attached to the agenda. So, and then if you remember last time, there were a whole bunch of other changes I made on rearranging the bullet points and all that. That stays. That's all good. But we are now proposing that the number, you know, I've got this as number 1, but I think it's number 2. In any case, student representatives will be selected in the spring prior to the year they will serve as representatives. The term of office will be for 2 years, beginning in July of the application year and ending in June. So basically, July to June, July to June. Seniors will serve 1 year from July to June. And after this year, we'll probably take that line out. The overlap of terms will allow for mentorship by the more experienced representatives. We also have a line in there that says students are eligible to apply for additional terms. And yeah, we would need to delete that. Okay, there's a missing parenthesis in 3. That's no big deal. Wanted to clarify in 9 that the civics government teacher, I believe Andrea told me, is from that high school. Nod? Yes. Okay. So the student rep, the civics teacher, and the ASB person on the interview team are all from that high school. So those will differ. It will still be the 2 school board directors. Okay. And then I was proposing, because we did talk about this a little bit, and we did have some attendance issues this year, that we add a 12, so the current 12 would become 13, in the event that a student representative is unable to complete their term of office, the board may appoint another student representative from the list of applicants. And that could be that the student comes to us and says, hey, this is bigger than I thought, I can't do it. Or it could be that we say, you know, that Skyline kid hasn't shown up for 3 months and we need to move along with something different. Mm-hmm. And don't be offended, Skyline, I just picked you out of thin air. I did want to mention, because we did meet to select the candidates, so I just wanted to say we had 80 applicants for 8 positions, which blew my mind. They were all incredibly excellent. It was very, very difficult to winnow 80 down to 8. So I want to thank everybody that applied. And if you got the letter that said, we're so sorry, we can't interview you, please don't take it personally. You were awesome. We could just only pick 8. So, the other change I noted is number 7, which talks about when we conduct the interviews. I think there was some conversation that this April-May timeframe is a little bit late and we'll probably push that earlier, but we'll leave it where it is for now because that's what we're actually doing this year. So first off, does that make sense? And secondly, does anybody comments, input? I know I sort of sprang this on you. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I have a question. So since it's a going forward, it's a 2-year commitment. So all the applicants would only be currently freshmen and sophomores.
After this year, that is correct. This year, we are interviewing seniors.
So,
because we don't, with the exception of Liberty, we don't have anybody that is continuing on.
Well, I was just looking at your number 8 because it talks about in order to qualify to serve as a student representative, the applicant must be in grade 10, 11, or 12 during their term of office.
I'm sorry.
And in a way, when they're an applicant, they must either be going to be into 10th or 11th. So it's confusing because it's during their time of being a student rep, they could be in 10 or 11 or 12. Yeah, but when they're an applicant, that seems
funny,
a little odd.
I read that and I thought, no, that's still okay because the representatives are 10, 11 or 12, but you're right. So it's the applicant in order to qualify to serve as a student representative.
I think it's accurate.
It's not accurate if we say applicant. We can say in order to qualify as a student to serve as a student representative, the student must be.
That'd be fair.
So we can, so we could in number 8, we change. Oops. If only I could type change applicant to student.
And
yes, thank you for that catch because I looked at it and didn't catch
it. Because as they advertise at the high school for students to apply for this, they would only advertise to current freshmen and sophomore.
Yes.
Well, may I make a comment since I can't raise my hand?
Oh yes.
The voice from the ether. It depends on, we may also have an opening where somebody comes in, they serve their first year and then choose not to do the second. So I think leaving it as is okay because we may need applicants that are going to be seniors in the future.
Yeah, I still think I'd rather change it to student because in that case, it's always true. And if it's applicant, it's only sometimes true. So I just think there's more clarity if we say the student.
Mm-hmm. And I think just to the point of how you advertise it, I guess each year they just have to be clear what they are advertising for.
Yes.
Right. Because
yes.
If you are looking for people to do 2-year terms and you're staggering them, you're really only focused on the current freshman and sophomore, unless you have a different kind of opening, of which then you would indicate that would be true at that high school, because it might not be true across the board.
Or we could go back to our, depending on when that opening happens, we can go back to our original list of applicants.
Mm-hmm.
If they drop off before the end of the year, which is why I added 12.
Okay.
Anything else?
I'll just share that Jack and Mia from Liberty High School are confirmed and excited to continue their service. So we have 2, which I think we had kind of talked about, but I wanted to make sure I close a loop on that one.
Okay,
today.
I didn't realize that. So yes, so we will have an interesting glitch this year, that we will have 9. And then there was also some conversation and proposals to have 2 students at all times with us on the dais. And it will depend on whose EL is up and whatever. But I think it's difficult for the students when they're in the audience to know how to participate in the meeting. If we have two sitting up here, it's much easier. Yeah. You see a hand, you call on them. And that's the piece that I've been missing all along is I want to hear what their thoughts are on all the things we're discussing, even if they haven't pulled their entire student body. It's just that student. I would like to hear what they're thinking. So I feel good about that. And otherwise, I will get this cleaned up. I will give something to Diane that makes sense. I do apologize for this, but you know, it just kept changing on the fly. So that's all I have.
Happy to bring that back. Thank you for doing the work. Incredibly grateful that it is getting done, and really excited and proud that to come into the second year and to have such a large amount of interest in doing that role. I think certainly I'm grateful to our current students who've clearly done a good job at saying it's an awesome opportunity and participating with us, and thankful for this board to make it an interesting destination.
And I do want to add that it turns out that other organizations such as the Schools Foundation and the City of Issaquah's Equity Committee are actively looking for student representation. So if any of those 80 kids are listening, there are other opportunities to have your voice heard. And I know that the letters that Director Zier sent out to the students that we couldn't interview, I know they mentioned the foundation. And so I just wanted to add that the City of Issaquah is also looking, and there's probably others as well. So as we find those, maybe some of those very qualified candidates can find other organizations that would like to hear their voice.
It's fantastic. Thank you. Okay, next on the agenda, I see that we have CFO Turney joining us at the podium for our budget update and our continued conversation. I know we had a key moment in this process just end with the end of legislative session. So excited to hear what clarity, you know, we're getting out of that process. I don't know, Superintendent, if you wanted to start with any commentary. Okay, over to you, CFO Turney.
Okay, thank you. As you mentioned, the legislative session has concluded this past Sunday. Can you hear me? Okay, I'll lean in a little bit. Just don't mind me hunching over a little. So the legislative session is over. We have some clarity on a few things. So this is good for us. So we can get kind of started in some of the nuts and bolts of the budgeting process that we do internally. And so I wanted to give a brief preliminary bit of information on what we know now and how it may or may not impact our district in terms of the budget. So starting with just a high level, some of the big, the couple big things is special services revenue. We're estimating approximately $1.6 million above what we had included in our projections earlier in the year. So this is something above and beyond that. Also with the inflationary increase amount, whenever we have inflationary increases, it costs us something locally. And so earlier we were using a higher percentage. And so with a lower percentage in 3.7%, it costs us a little bit less. So that's something that works in a net positive for us as we think about fund balance in the 23-24 as we end that year. So that's something that works in our favor in terms of going forward with our budget. I'll just take a moment to thank the legislature at this point for their work. And I also want to thank the board for your advocacy throughout the session. So thank you there. So as mentioned, this is our estimate for the special education multipliers. So that's the big part of this bill that generates that $1.6 million for us as estimated. A couple of other key points in this bill included a increase of the special education enrollment funding cap from 13.5% to 15%. For our district, that really doesn't have an impact because we don't bump up against that cap. So for us right now, that's not something that really impacts us from the budget standpoint. It also included some safety net threshold change from what's currently what we can put in our application is students that had 2.3 times the average per pupil expenditure amount lowered to 2.2. So that could have an impact where we may be able to include some additional expenditures when we apply for safety net funding. We're not really going to know that until we get there because every year is a little different and what students are involved. So that's yet to be determined. Again, I mentioned the inflationary increase amount based on IPD. This time, more of a number that was not necessarily tied directly to IPD, but this again is what we typically include in our inflationary increase when we have our collective bargaining agreement amounts and we flow through to certain groups. So that's what that's based on. There was mention of an estimate of 3.9 for the 24-25 year. And what has changed is how it's going to be looked back. So it's going to be based on the previous calendar year at the beginning of that school year. And so for us going forward in future years, that's helpful because we will have some sort of predictability as we go to think about our budgets and what it's going to look like. So I see that as a positive. Typically, there's an increase for the costs that are not employee related. So those material supplies and operating costs, that per pupil amount, was increased by 3.1%. And as we know, things have been costing more and inflation has been a little bit higher than that. So we anticipate that's going to cost us a little bit at the local level. Currently estimated about $3 million. We will typically gather some additional information as we begin to plug in our utilities and fuel and those kind of more current estimates to see what that actually will look like cost-wise. So we'll have a little bit more detailed information on that as we get a little bit further in the process. Wanted to mention there was a change here for Running Start. It increased the combined maximum enrollment cap from 1.2 to 1.4, which I think is a positive for students. And that's a, you know, it's a good thing. It's typically a flow through for our district. So it doesn't necessarily impact us from the budget standpoint, other than we need to build in capacity for that as we think through that. One big topic from this session was free meals. So the free school meals, and what eventually happened was it appears to be, it's going to be isolated to elementary schools with a phased in process, 40% or higher free and reduced lunch starting in the first year and 30% or higher in the second year. We currently don't have any schools in the 30 or above. Our highest is right around 25%. So we are getting a little bit closer to that. And if in future years they lower that threshold or we go up, we may qualify to be able to begin providing those free meals of those buildings. Transitional kindergarten, there was a change in this, you know, this was one of those ones we were watching till the last minute on how it was gonna look. So. Changing to a new transition to kindergarten, a little bit different. And they're going to, looks like, pull the funding away from general apportionment. So it's a little bit more isolated and transparent. So the funding is going to be based on the child as a kindergarten student, again, reported separately. So because of how this is going to be counted and funded as a kindergarten student, I'm not envisioning this changing much in terms of our funding. I think the earlier versions and some things and calculations that they were thinking about doing would have had more of an impact on us. But right now, I don't think this is going to change much in terms of revenue for that program. Now, I know there's probably a lot of other changes included in that bill and some other things that are going to change how we operate. But in terms of the budget, I don't see much coming out from that. One exciting thing, and I guess Tom's gone and we have some other people working on this, but we were able to, in the capital budget, there was $1 million set aside for the Issaquah School District. Several folks worked on applying for some assistance through the Department of Commerce for the Holly Street Learning Center playground. So that was funded through the capital budget, which is great. The total project cost for that is about $1.8 million. So to be able to have a million come in is exciting. So that's great. And so I just wanted to wrap up with some, you know, kind of next steps. Where are we in the process? We're going to utilize what we know now, and we're going to continue to scrutinize what's coming, what came out from the legislature. There's a lot to go through, as you can imagine, and we want to make sure we capture everything that may impact us as a district. And then we get into our detailed budget work, which includes, you know, finalizing our enrollment estimates based on that kind of last version of our projected enrollment amounts or accounts, factoring in planned reductions and program changes, creating our staffing plan so we can have more precise budget amounts for those employee-related costs. We also, as I mentioned, will be updating our inflationary cost estimates for all those other things that we pay for other than labor. We're also gonna be looking to determine any possible impact of early attrition on our current fund balance and where we might end up. And then again, going through and incorporating all the full legislative changes into the revenue expenditure amounts. We will be working through that in the next month or two to get something that we can put out in July as a preliminary document, as we typically do. We also work on and complete after we have a fact meeting, we finalize our guide to understanding the budget in July. And that all culminates with the public hearing in August, and then hopefully an adoption by the board and that last meeting. So that's kind of how I wanted to close out. And are there any questions?
Any questions, Director Maraldo?
None from me.
Thank you. Any other comments? Thank you very much. Very clear.
Thank you.
Okay, next on our agenda, we have the adoption of our vision statement.
I move the board adopt the Issaquah School District vision statement as presented.
Second.
Thank you. Superintendent, would you like to start us off?
I would love to and invite up a director of senior supervisor and strategy lead. I'm so sorry. It's getting, I'm getting a little bit, getting late for me. So yes, thank you, Marcel Hauser, for joining. And I'll just kick us off and then transition over to Marcel here. But really, this is just a very short presentation to support the board's discussion and remind the public about where we are in the process and how we got to this point and how things connect. So really, if we look at the PowerPoint slide two, thank you. The vision sits on top of everything, and it really sits on top of all of the work that the board has done to develop a clear set of ends and to articulate the mission and the district goals for our students. And below that are the various areas that we'll be touching upon later in the next presentation on strategic plan. But this is where we are in this conversation on the vision and the North Star, which is the way in which the organization and Issaquah School District will change the world. This sits on top, as I said, the district mission and ends, which is on the next slide, as a reminder of our three district goals, as well as our mission. And you've all seen that before. And with that, I'll pass it to Marcel to introduce himself again and take us to this next set of content.
Good evening, Marcel Hauser, Senior Advisor in Strategy. I got it right.
Yes, you did.
So I want to highlight on the next slide, you'll see, this is a reminder slide. We shared this last board meeting. This was around the engagement with the strategic plan. We had, we met with several groups around the community. So parents met with staff members. The board was instrumental in serving this up and supporting this. But also we put out a thought exchange. So we sent out in the community and we really crowdsourced the idea. Help us finish this sentence Mad Lib style. So the sentence we started with was ISD students thrive as they engage in meaningful learning that unlocks their passion and potential. And we intentionally left it blank. Community responded in focus group meetings, but also through thought exchange. And so thank you everybody again for your participation and engagement. The next slide, and this was actually a happy coincidence because as I went back, we presented the, it was 12 or so options at the last board meeting. And we landed on one particular finishing sentence. When I did went back to my notes and feedback and scoured through the documents, it actually came from a student group. So during a visit with the Skyline Black Student Union, they, you know, gave us these finishing sentences. So the "to positively impact the world" came from our students. So thought it was a nice sort of conclusion to our sort of process. I'm going to pass back to Superintendent to read the draft sentence.
So I'll read this out loud and then pass it back to President Mullings for the conversation. So the vision, as it stands from where the board left our last meeting, is all students thrive as they engage in meaningful learning that unlocks their passion and potential to positively impact the world. And with that, over to you, President Mullings.
Thank you. I want to make sure we have an opportunity before we start to dialogue, if there's any public comment on this topic. So I don't know if there's any comment within the room. If there's any on Zoom, no, thank you. And leave an opportunity for the board to have any final reaction or thoughts before we go forward and potentially vote.
I still love it. And I just thought it was so cute. At the ISF lunch, we had a young student, the Apollo student that was there with their counselor, and they were talking about the Purposeful People program. And she talked about how they were taught that everyone can make the world a better place, which falls right in line with our everyone can positively impact the world. So it came right out of our students in another way as well.
I think someone actually used the words impact the world because my spidey sense went up on that one.
Same
too.
Time.
That was just so cool. And I really like the idea that a student can impact the world in any way. It can be as simple as, you know, picking up a piece of trash, right? I mean, you don't have to go out and change the planet. It's just, I think it can mean so many things to each and every student. That's why I like it.
Mm-hmm. I would like to see us have a little district video that goes through kindergarten through 12th grade. And we hear from our preschool, actually, through beyond 12th grade, since we do have students from 3 to 21, on what is it that positively impact the world? Like, what does that mean to them? And how do they intend to positively impact the world? I think that would just be a really powerful video that would, I think, would really bring home and make real for our students, our teachers, our community members on why this is so important and broad-based and meaningful for all students, all ages. So that would be a great way for us to be able to kick off the next school year.
I just have to say, I love that idea.
Mm-hmm. I got a little emotional with that one. Thank you, Director Hunter. Director Meraldo.
So, no, I love the statement. I wish I could have been at the ISF luncheon today and to see it in action. And do we have a motion on the table?
We do have a motion on the table.
Oh, I did want to also mention that Superintendent Taoyuk shared it.
I was going to.
Oh, I'm sorry. I steal your thunder.
Well, it depends on what you say. Go ahead.
that she shared the vision statement at the, was it the State of the City?
And yes.
There was a rumbling of applause.
Yes. Yeah, that was great. That was really wonderful to hear it resonate through the room in the State of the City in that joint event. So yes, I love it. I thought it was amazing when I was like, hey, that was one of the suggestions. Can you find where it came from? And it was just amazing to find out that came from a group of our own students that really made it feel perfect. Mm-hmm. So thank you for all the work. I think it's important. And I think we should vote if we're approving this vision statement. So all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It passes.
Yay.
Oh, thank you.
Congratulations on a lot of really good work.
Really, really great. And I got choked up thinking about the video. So that's a winning presentation, I think. Thank you. Awesome. So that leads us very directly on, because they tied together, into a presentation on the strategic plan and a discussion we've been having about what is the proper way to memorialize that, the strategic plan. And so we won't be taking action this evening, but we'll start the conversation. So I believe I'll start with you, Superintendent, as well.
Great. So we'll be brief on this presentation itself, because really the purpose of our time today on the next slide is to present the current strategic plan draft and then the discussion around the resolution language that was developed by the board and for the board to consider. So you've seen the next slide on slide three, which is the triangle, which shows how everything fits together. And as I said in the last conversation on vision, we're now talking about the level of priority areas, goals, metrics, and strategies. I will pass it to Marcel to sort of take it from here, and then I'll come back in at some point.
Perfect. So this slide, and I'll try to be brief, but we've showed our engagement throughout, but this slide is just to indicate that it started way back November 2021. So this process, we built on the existing processes before. So our engagement's gone beyond, and you'll see this slide again. This has grown, continued to grow. So we've been meeting with student groups as recently as Liberty last week. And it's just want to thank everybody in the community for being a part of these conversations. Really want to thank the student groups, especially seniors who have been a part of different clubs and have shared their student experience and lived experience. And even though this plan is in the next 3 years and it won't necessarily impact them, they've been kind and generous enough to share that impact with their experience, helping the incoming kindergartners and the kids that come behind them. So thank you to the students as well. This slide is just again, in the beginning of our process, we saw trends that came out through leadership interviews, interviews with the board. We had a consultant group, Delivery Associates, who was a part of this work. And four trends really jumped out. So one was around disparities with behavior, academic metrics, the reduction in student stress with a trend that jumped out. The diversity in their workforce was a trend. And also, how do we improve operational consistency? So you think about continuous improvement, how do we improve our systems and structures? So those were the early trends. I'm gonna take a little bit more time on this to set this slide up. The next one, sorry, Steve. So this particular slide, now, a lot of this is work that we did in January and February. So the more intensive engagement going out to the community groups, talking to the students. This is meant just to show themes across. So I'm going to help navigate on this slide. If you look to your left, underneath parents, the very first row, you'll see importance of student well-being. Well-being is the theme. And as you scroll from left to right, you'll start to see each group sort of highlighted or had a sentiment around student well-being. So they shared that similar theme across. The other pieces, you go row to row below that, accountability is a theme. So in one case, it's accountability around issues of discrimination with parents and students. That was really prominent in a lot of conversations. So when things are reported, what happens to that report? What's the follow-up and resolution to something that's reported? You'll see in the middle, it's not that teachers didn't also feel that same way, but in interviews with Delivery Associates, that didn't come up at that one time, that instance, but I'm sure they would stand behind what's said here as well. You have community groups who talked around progress monitoring. So how do we know what we're doing is working? So can we ask that question, how are we tracking it? So similar to the accountability thing. And then board has also talked about disproportionate results around behavior and academic achievement. It's been a consistent conversation with us. Below that, so pathway conversations, how do we create additional pathways for students? So parents felt really strongly about that. You know, the board has as well. So how do we illuminate the pathways for students? And then also we talked this at the work session around academic standards and grading practices. So that's something that was really important for students as we went out in the community and shared. And then below, I'll just mention for brevity to kind of move along, recruitment of diverse staff. So diversity around that. And also how do we communicate in a way that's culturally appropriate came up throughout multiple groups. So how do we do that in an authentic way? I'm going to pass it back to Superintendent Toyik to walk us through our high-level architecture.
Okay, great. Thank you, Marcel. So on the next slide, we see here, we have really had our priority areas remain unchanged, although somehow on organizational effectiveness, that sometimes keeps getting mixed up with some other older versions, but it's organizational effectiveness. And we are really have been fine tuning some of the language around the goal areas. And so most of this should be fairly familiar to the board and to many of the public, but we have been fine tuning that to make sure that we are reflecting the feedback along the way. So that's a sort of a key point on this one. And you'll notice a couple of changes, I think, that are embedded underneath when we look at the actual strategies and some of the alignment and shifting of where that work is being prominently pulled forward or pulled up one level or down a level. Not to say it's a level of importance, but it's really just where it sits in the architecture. One notable opportunity is to talk about under academic opportunity, really focusing on student achievement, but also decreasing gaps at the same time. So keeping the bar high for students, but also closing opportunity gaps. And then having a specific, we pulled up a level from the strategy level to the goal area of focus on resources and pathways that support post-high school goals. And I think that is very germane and relevant based on the discussion you had from the report out on NSBA, as well as ASU-GSV. So I'll just call out some of those. And we did have a lot of conversation around what is authentic engagement. And we heard that conversation from the board, but also really getting a little more clear on that. And specifically, you know, really it's not just about what is engagement and two-way engagement. So we've added some specific words like listen and follow up, which were at the core of what people are interested in as it relates to working across many constituent groups. So those are some of the highlights that I'll note there. And then there's some other details that get shifted below in the strategy level that I'll pass it back to Marcel for walking us through.
On the next slide, you'll see, so just to orient to this slide here, so top level is description of what this priority area is about. So again, this is around students feeling safe, affirmed in their strengths, and having access to resources and basic needs support. So that's what this priority area is about. Underneath that are the two goals that Superintendent Tarjic just described and walked through. And in the dark green box, you're going to see the strategies. Again, these are draft strategies. So we've been refining based on feedback. So we're consistently refining. They're meant to be agile. So as we move throughout, you know, going into the next 3 years, if we measure and we see things aren't working, we should be able to shift and pivot. Like, we shouldn't stay with something that's not working. So they're meant to be agile. And I would note the next level is to create work plans based on these strategies. So that's the work we're going to do May to July. So in that time, we're going to start to build out work plans and look for alignment between. So I'll highlight a couple, and there's five of these areas. So I'm trying to be kind of moving them pretty quick. But one kind of highlight, if we look at examine curriculum and the importance of school experiences to better represent diversity of our students, we heard that directly from students asking for more representation in curriculum. So that came pretty consistently as we were on school visits, talking to kids. They wanted to see themselves reflected in the curriculum. The other one below it is around safety. And this was one that we sort of toggled with back and forth. We talked a lot about with the board about this topic, mm-hmm. how physical safety was truly important to make sure it stayed connected to emotional safety. We had almost a cousin strategy or sister strategy in the organizational effectiveness, almost said it the wrong name. we had a sister strategy in that lane, and we decided to move it here just to put it in one space so you're not having to go back and forth. So you'll see the addition of physical safety in that bottom bullet point, which couples with the emotional safety. That's fine. On the academic area, Superintendent Toya, she highlighted a couple. So I'll just mention the refinement of the goal areas. So from feedback from working sessions, we then made it more prominent. So goal two really is about pathways. So as you read down and you'll see the strategies there related, we made that more prominent to say that's our strategy or pathway goal area. And then goal one is really about those opportunity gaps. How do we support students in that work? Make sure that we're lifting students up to the high bar. So our third area is around diverse talent. And I'll speak to this is, you know, this is a key theme that came up as we look at goal one with our parents wanting to see more diversity in the staff as supporting students. So as you look down the strategies and you start to see a focus on hiring practices. You're seeing a focus on the commitment to building partnerships that include relocation and the commitment to diversity and inclusion. We want to focus in deeper into like, how do we bring people in? That's sort of our goal area one. When you look over to goal area two, it's now how do we create an environment where there's belonging and folks want to stay? So as you look at the areas under, there's PD. That's something that teachers and other staff community members asked about, like how do we support staff? And then the bottom, the second bullet on grow and offer resources, it's all around supporting staff throughout the life cycle. So how do we, you know, encourage folks to, you know, grow and how do we move them along if they want to grow and they want to change positions? So how do we support that as a system? Our fourth area is around authentic engagement. And this one, we had a rich discussion in this area. Mm-hmm. A lot of conversation on what does authentic engagement actually mean? When I'm harking back to a conversation around to the communication inbound, outbound that came up a lot. So how do we communicate with folks? How do we make sure we're listening to community, truly listening? So we wanted to add that language in. The first strategy you see there is around the toolkit. So that's a system-wide toolkit that could be used by all the other priority areas, but also other departments on creating that authentic feedback loop throughout. On the bottom, you have your engagement component for an annual community report. So adding that. If you look to the right, there's basically the sister strategy is you create the toolkit, then you need to implement the toolkit. So that's your strategy there. And then the bottom, which is I think is super huge work, is how do you co-design systems with communities? That's a massive sort of strategy that you're doing. It's in a two-way sort of collaborative fashion. So a lot of work in this area. I think a lot of work to come, but I know folks are really excited about digging in with community. And our fifth and final, which is not effective operations, it is organizational effectiveness, is all around that continuous improvement, supporting systems. How do we make sure we're creating cycles throughout, but also supporting other departments on here is the process for looking at a process, refining it, documenting it, and then improving it. But there's also, how do we create more transparency around, if you look at goal area two, our budgeting process? How do we create a transparent, equity-based budgeting framework? And then the second bullet under goal two is all around, how do we partner with communities to inform facilities and resource allocation decisions? So there's some transparency, collaboration with community on budgeting, but also continuous improvement of systems in goal one. So that was a lot. There's a lot of content there. I will stop and rest there.
Great. Thank you, Marcel. I have nothing further to add. So eager to hear discussion from the board and if you want to look at the resolution next, or if you want to do that after discussion, we can flex.
So let's see if there's any, I guess, immediate reactions, comments on the content of the plan, and then we can go to the resolution if that's okay. I guess I get to pick, so that's what we'll do. So any immediate comments on the plan as presented, its updates?
First, I want to express gratitude for the amount of work and the transition. Thank you for sending us all the versions from the start to the finish. That was really helpful for me, at least. And there's been a lot of change, especially those first two priority areas and what it looks like. I think you guys are really hitting the mark there on representing like what is well-being, what are the two goals with it, and then the academic part, especially bringing in and elevating. It's really about the outcomes. That's what our mission is. So to say, hey, what does this high school experience look like and meeting the needs of every student? So thank you for that. Authentic engagement, I think it's for me still a work in progress. Goal one, I appreciate that listen is in there. I think what I worry about is staff is one of those key constituent groups. So maybe it could say system leaders and staff will listen and follow up on input from constituent groups, because I worry this burden isn't on our staff. It's not one more thing for our staff to do, but I mean, our principals are a constituent group, our teachers, our staff members. So it's not just, we want them to be good customer service for our community. We want them also they're also our customers. So I think having it say system leaders and staff would, I think, be more helpful to scratch the itch that I'm really looking for, because this building is ultimately what's responsible and ultimately who I want to see be responsive to and model what listening and that serve and return conversation and dialogue looks like with our community members and our key constituents. Has any thoughts on that or responses to that?
Others?
I will just say yes. I think that in our language iteration, we do view staff as a key constituent group. And so that is a helpful naming and probably just a minor miss that we had in our iteration process. So really grateful that you brought that up. And I saw Marcel and I sort of looking at each other with a yes, complete agreement. And we can work that through so it's more clear.
Then if anyone else, then I think for me, I appreciate you list strategies. I think what I'm missing, especially as we have to go to the resolution part, is what are some of the actual measurables that you're going to do? So specifically under number two of academic opportunity, milestones. So since the goals don't list, I'm not saying the goals should list what those milestones are. But if when the resolution, the first one is like the board supports all or the whole plan, whatever the word language was used, we don't the entirety, but we don't actually see it in its entirety. So I'm a little uncomfortable with that wording just because I would want to see like, what are the milestones and what are the targets that we're talking about? So I know there's a dance there and it's not that I'm saying like, okay, so what are they right now tonight before we go forward? But I think the language at least needs to mirror the flexibility in that, because I don't see what the targets actually are.
At one point, there were metrics embedded in the plan.
Yeah, so I'll take that and then Marcel can add on to that. So at the goal area, we had shown different metrics that would support the goal area at large, which I think is helpful. So the way we were talking about this was the goal area language is the sort of qualitative representation of what we were trying to measure on a numerical basis or quantitative level. And as we started to continue to iterate, we didn't want to use metrics to become the driver of then what actually we wanted to be true with the spirit behind what we were trying to really accomplish. So that work needs more work. We also want to know sometimes when you measure something, you might be measuring the wrong thing. And so there's a lot of adaptive work that we need to do and just conversation around the strategy level. And that's part of the implementation planning that will go forward at the strategy level as we build out work plans, which we have not started to do. But I know people are starting to think about who is the owner of this particular strategy? How does that fit in with our current work? Give it shape and purpose in a different way. And some of that there'll be lots of metrics. So in part of our implementation planning, we will have something called a strategy profile, which then actually lists out this strategy. For example, if we were to look at design and implement academic interventions for literacy and math at each grade level, there's a whole work plan behind that, which pairs with our current work, but also is focused in a different way and would also want to tie that to our ends work as well. So we haven't gotten to that level. And I will say, frankly, I don't think that would happen in the next two weeks. That's actually ongoing work that we need to really do through even summer and have even a stronger conversation as we launch for next year, so we know what we're starting to look at. That also leads to regular reporting on certain measures. And again, back to the three M's, measurable, manageable, and movable. So our ends reports are often looking backwards, and we're looking at data that sometimes that is once a year, twice a year, but we want to start looking at data that's actually very easy for us to look at on a quick manner or a very routine and frequent manner to know whether or not we are on or off track. So we're going to have a lot of learning even next year from that as well. So that was sort of a long way of saying there's a lot more work coming and we're eager to take that on at the strategy level. And on the goal level, we haven't kept pace with sort of the numerical representation of what the goal actually means. So Marcel, would you add anything and then comments back and how we, you know, address that as we move forward with the resolution, but also just, you know, ongoing requests from the board.
You know, so you covered the bases, but I would add that The work plans, internal work plans, will include milestones, which will be a roll-up of activities, smaller sort of activities throughout. So we're going to internally track those milestones and systematize it and track how we're doing, check the health of things. So that we do have plans for that. And that work, that phase is beginning now through May through summer. So and a part of that is we need to look at each work plan and look for alignment as well. Mm-hmm. So folks will create their work plans with smaller details. And the goal for us is not to have things cascade, because somebody can come create something that gets way off base, right? And now you're sort of overlapping with someone else's plan. So there's a whole work stream, and it's a lot of work to come, but it's work that we're going to engage in the next few months.
And I totally appreciate that honesty and transparency to that answer. And that's what I would expect. And I wouldn't expect you guys to have that right now. I think I don't want the metrics to be the tail wagging the dog. That's not the point. But then I think that our resolution for me to feel comfortable with it would probably need to say, a resolution of the Issaquah School District Board of Directors supporting the superintendent's priority areas and goals outlined in the strategic plan. Because that's the part what we would be supporting. And I don't believe we should get down into the nuances anyway. That comes in the monitoring part. So I know I'm transitioning, sorry, President Mullins, but that's why I've
tried to
outline the conversation for what part was missing from what Director Moore said. Like, we saw those initially, so we got little glimpses of them.
Right.
So I know that you guys are working on them, and I don't think that they belong in our resolution even, but I would say that I would then want to change the wording to reflect what parts we're standing behind. And that's why in its entirety, just really kind of struck me as like, that's not, that doesn't fit, seems to me, with what's presented.
Well, look, I get an opportunity about what was created before we start commenting on it.
Yes. Would you like to go ahead now?
Yes, that'd be great. So I did take that language just based off of my start was the Federal Way resolution. So that was kind of a jump off point. And I'd say out of all of that stuff, that was the one line that I took from theirs and didn't craft on my own. What I tried to do with this is build it from the board's work, try to touch base on some Washington state standards about how we develop a district plan and how we look at continuous improvement throughout our schools, and then talked about the superintendent and staff's work at developing the strategic plan and how it is, it defines the operations and priorities that by which the reasonable progress towards the vision and ends will be made. I also mention the way in which they engaged the community and including staff to develop that. So to tie back to that they were adhering to what's in our what's in the WASDA Washington State board standards. Then talked about the five priority areas. So much to your point, Harlan, if that's the area that's what we want to define as that's what we're approving, or that excuse me, not approving, supporting, that we can certainly talk about that. And then the superintendent did the work to ensure that they were aligning with our ends and executive limitations. I mentioned that I put in here that it was an expression of the board's commitment to ensure, and then I put in the vision statement. I didn't know how the board was going to vote, but I kind of made an assumption based on previous conversations to go ahead and include it there. And then I did say that the board therefore supports the superintendent's strategic plan and acknowledges its alignment to the ends and executive limitations. So I certainly think that changing the wording at the top to say that the board supports the superintendent's priorities and goals as specified in her plan, that that change can be pretty easily made, I think.
And you get to change the number four of the whereases, because the board has now adopted that vision statement.
Yes, exactly.
Thank you, Director Meraldo. Any other, I guess we'll do comments on either one. We've opened it up. So on the material, the substantive part of the plan that we have to date, or the resolution. We're not taking action this evening, so this is purely discussion that will be into the next version.
I had a question for everybody. You know, one of the second to the last whereas is, you know, you talk about board's annual monitoring of ends and executive limitations will allow for the annual monitoring of the strategic plan. And do we expect that to be through ends one monitoring? Then to me, it'd be nice just to add that part in there to kind of make that explicit. I realize it because it talks about, you know, through ends and executive limitations. And yes, we've always had ends one, but we've never actually monitored it.
I agree. That was going to be one of my suggestions I should say, whereas the board's annual monitoring of E1 or ends one mission allows for the annual monitoring of the strategic plan.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You can put it in the therefores.
Oh,
because it's not really a whereas the board has never actually monitored that. Therefore, I mean, I can add the whereas that we haven't monitored that and that we have in the therefore.
Well, but the whereas talks about, you know, will allow for annual monitoring right. of the strategic plan. I guess what you feel like it's saying is that our normal ends and executive limitation monitoring is a monitoring of the strategic plan.
Correct.
Yeah, I don't.
Because they have mapped everything in the strategic plan back to an ends or an executive limitation. So my assumption is that when they do come up with what those measurements are, they will find those we'll find those measurements in our ends or executive limitations.
Fair. But I also think, and it could be either in a whereas or a therefore. I just think it would be good to have it explicit in here that we pull it all together right. and look at the strategic plan and monitor it through ends one monitoring.
If you put it in the therefores, it becomes a way of saying where our expectation or setting the expectation that we monitor it.
Yeah, then I guess that would be my suggestion.
Yeah, I don't care where it belongs, but that was really an important part of what
we make that
I brought forward.
Stand. And to her point, it is something new that we're doing, hence her therefore.
Then I would probably say we don't need that whereas that we're talking about.
Well, actually, they're both true.
Mm-hmm.
Because to Director Meraldo's point, as we go through each end in EL, we are monitoring bits and pieces of the strategic plan. That's a true statement. It is also true that with the monitoring of ends one, you're doing the whole thing. I actually think it's okay to leave them both in there. It's a little redundant, but I don't know. I think they're both important.
I like leaving it in there because back to my big marks on the ruler and my little marks on the ruler, I want to make sure as we're monitoring each piece along the way that we can say, what about this plan is helping move this along?
Mm-hmm.
But yes, I also agree being clear that the strategic plan in its totality,
mm-hmm.
maybe that's not the right way I'm supposed to say it, but the ends one monitoring will be the place where we look at the overall progress mm-hmm. of the plan.
And the other thing is by leaving them both in there, you're monitoring the strategic plan continuously mm-hmm. because each monitoring report is picking on something rather than, once a year when we monitor mm-hmm. ends one, we're monitoring the plan. I like leaving them both.
Right. I agree with that because it would be very odd to end up doing any of our ends monitoring and not be incorporating some of these things that they see as their important metrics.
Thank you, Director Meraldo, for drafting this.
Absolutely.
I know it was a ton of work.
Thank you.
So when I create the new therefore, is there a time frame by which we want to have the first monitoring? Do we want to have it in the next year's calendar?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
That's what I was expecting as well.
In 2023-24.
Any additional comments about the content of the plan so far? Are you staying on the resolution? Sorry. Oh, go ahead.
So first page, the second whereas from the bottom. I don't understand the language of define the operations and priorities, blah, blah, blah. It seems like that should I'll say the priority areas and goals, just because that's the language that's used and that's the language that we're supporting.
Okay, I'll make that edit.
And then somewhere it needs to, whether it's in the resolution at the top about the strategic plan. So if you're, say, supporting the superintendent's 3-year strategic plan, or somewhere it needs to talk about the duration.
Mm-hmm.
And I would prefer it's right at the top. Mm-hmm. It says this Issaquah School District Board of Directors supporting the superintendent's 3-year strategic plan. Or sorry, supporting the superintendent's priority areas and goals in the 3-year strategic plan.
Yeah.
Just somewhere it needs to be highlighted, because it is a time limited thing in a good way.
Okay, I noted that.
So maybe what I will do is just share my thanks. I feel like in reading through the content, and I don't feel like I want to call it the plan, because we're being very specific about the pieces we have so far, but the priority areas, the goals, et cetera, I think there's a number of items in here that the evolution of the language, it really shows a level of listening and taking in the feedback along the way. And there's a couple that I thought were quite good or stood out to me. And so the first, under authentic engagement, I completely agree with adding district leadership to it. But I think there's a lot of clarity in being very clear on that it's about listening and following up. And so I just thought, while that's simple language, I think simple language is good, and it shows a clear intent. And so I liked that one. I liked that one quite a bit. And then there was I'm appreciative of the update on the safety to include the physical safety as well. I know that they were both there, but it does feel better to have them together and cover the, I don't know if it's the universe, but multiple facets. So I think that was really helpful. And I think that the academic opportunity updates, the having the first one being about both achievement and gap closure, making that one, then leaving space to talk about the pathways with part two, I think that works really well. So just going through it, I was like, yes, okay. Like, I feel like we've really made advancements over the course of the work. And I think it's really good. Obviously, we can keep making changes and making it better, but this draft just feels a lot like we've made a step change. I don't know if there's other comments, but that was my thinking going through. Do you feel like that's enough input on resolution, Director Moraldo, to help with next draft?
I think so.
Thank you. Marcel, Superintendent, is that enough input on the content of the strategic plan?
Yes, very helpful. Thank you for all of that feedback.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, Board, anything else?
I would just say the first, be it resolved. We should, again, just align the language. So it says superintendent's 2023 strategic plan. So it'd say superintendent's 3-year strategic plan.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. A lot of good work coming to fruition this evening. Appreciate it. Thank you, Marcel. And I've been doing a lot of too much scrolling in my list. Okay. So next on the agenda, I believe we get into a series of superintendent interpretation reviews. Our first one on the agenda is interpretation of EL 2. Oh, I'm sorry. Can I back up? Mm-hmm. Thank Jordan. Is there any comment you would like to make about the strategic plan as you were here for that?
Sorry.
You weren't here at the beginning, so I didn't prep to ask. And so I was like, oh, he's.
So hi, I'm Jordan. I'm a school board member for Issaquah School District. And I didn't really have any comment. I feel like I read over both of them. And well, I read over EL 15 and I just read over EL 2. And it, I feel like they're both pretty clear. I don't really feel like there's much changing to do there.
Okay, thank you, sir. And thank you for joining us. So Superintendent, I will turn it over to you for the first interpretation.
Okay, great. The first of three, as I sequence myself and get oriented, is EL2. So this one was, just as a reminder, I always like to reground ourselves in the facts, is this was last monitored on August 25th, but that was pushed back in the prior calendar to be... Yeah, so we're overlapping the same year basically with the same reports, is my point. And I just want to say thank you to Sophia as a student representative to the board who had provided input based on various conversations and a survey that was distributed at Liberty High School. And some of those themes really echo some of the past conversation with the board, but also the conversation with the board in August of 22. Around how we handle complaints, right? And how do we both formally and informally understand, excuse me, how we are doing? Are we getting better? I think we assume that the absence of complaints is not the goal. It's actually I think this very much links actually to the strategic plan and what we were just talking about with listening and follow-up and authentic engagement, but also continuous learning and having those loops of feedback where we're saying, we heard this, and this is how we're making adjustments. And this is also why we can't make adjustments for different reasons that are either legal or, you know, other practical matters as well. So really it's about, I've tried to make some changes to the interpretation that help bring that forward and to be more explicit about some of the aspect that we do need to develop, I think, some of the systems. That was part of the conversation with the board in August. Do we actually have some of those systems in place to be able to follow up, respond, and understand system trends and system improvement? And I will note, while we're not putting forward suggestions for monitoring evidence, I do want to remind ourselves of the note to make sure that we look at, as part of our evidence, the mandatory reporting. Training and how we're doing that to ensure that we are staying in line with our laws and making sure that our students are getting what they need if we see something, to see something, say something. So that's just a high level of some of the changes. And so you see all the track changes, including the strikeout of the evidence. We'll carry that method moving forward. I know it's helpful to see those red line changes across the whole board, not just partially. And I am eager for any feedback or additions or suggestions.
Thank you. We did say we would do public comment for this agenda item. Is there any in the room? Is there any on Zoom? Thank you. Board, any comments or feedback on the updated interpretation?
I'll say I like that number two focuses it on student well-being rather than student achievement. We have so many different parts of our ends and ELs that talk about student achievement. And this really is about how do you feel? And so I appreciate that because I think that will then change what evidence is. And I think slowly pivot our philosophy and culture to creating a culture of support and learning. And not one on achievement and grades, which ultimately, I think, as we've talked about, at least in the iteration we currently have, it can be damaging to student well-being or counterproductive to student well-being.
Thank you. Director Moraldo, any comments?
Nothing specific. I mean, I do appreciate, I think there's a lot of really good changes that, you know, I think it also helps me understand as you're working through the strategic plan, how you will envision interpreting this through that plan and through the work. So I appreciate that.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions, discussion?
I like number six, where you use the language from the now approved vision statement. I think that we're going to see, and that's going to be a large part of our talk up here at this space. I think that's really important, because I think that will undergird our approach for what we think about. Let's re-envision and reframe what high school looks like, because I think, again, in our current state, it works for a lot of kids, but it doesn't work for all kids. And that's our hope, is that high school works for all kids. And so thank you for that aspirational language, because I think that's really important, and it speaks to the alignment here.
Let's say I like, number seven, where talks about the ethical use, brings in that notion.
Can I do have one comment, going back and reviewing on number four? I do feel like the one thing missing in your interpretation is bullet point B, about how it includes people in the decisions that affect them. Because I think that piece, the mentioning of the people, I feel is like, who does that include to you, and what is meant by that?
Thank you for saying that. I had several constructions of this sentence and I couldn't work it in perfectly, but I can figure that out. But I had a whole series of thoughts around that and wondering if it would be embedded in or it needs to be more explicit. So thank you. I can certainly change that.
Okay, if we don't have any more discussion on this point, Superintendent, does that give you the feedback that you needed?
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right.
Next.
Should I roll into two of three?
We're doing great.
Okay, so EL 15 has typically been on consent, but in the spirit of moving forward with looking at interpretations and in the spirit of AI and the ChatGPT, GPT-4 conversations, this is one that was very helpful. And in the spirit of the fact that we now have a one-to-one program. This had some more significant revision to be reflective of the current work of the district to ensure that we are providing technology throughout the district. As well as some of the implications of what it means to be using more social media, more applications, more software to do the work. So those were the biggest changes there, in addition to simplifying some of the language, working in the concept of ethics, and being more discreet around some of the, there are components to how we are using technology from a do the work, but also with our students. And so making sure some of those discrete components around software, inventory control, replacement, were just made very explicit in some of the areas. I do want to say, so backing up, looking back at my notes, thank you to Paige and to Jordan, who is here tonight. Thank you, Jordan, for providing this input. And I took a lot of themes around the clarity of expectations. There are some things around color printers that were brought forward, and we just need to, solve that and follow up on that one. But really looking at sort of the speed of hardware, and that's how I kind of came up with the sort of concept of the replacement and inventory controls set of comments that are included here in EL 15. And then just the general, I heard this sort of theme for like more choice and options that are tailored to students and content. So those are things that I think can start to work their way through some of the evidence as we move forward. As a reminder to myself, I had to remember that in this case, our interpretation, my interpretation might actually be ahead of what we're monitoring from last year and is more in pace for this year. But I know we were putting putting foundations in place to get to this point of 1-to-1. So I'm just noting that mismatch as we bring forward evidence for review and monitoring as well. And those were my big picture comments.
Thank you. So I'll ask again for any public input, if there's any in the room or if there's any on Zoom. There is not. So board, for discussion.
I think the key one on here is number 4. And I love that you have just this very simple sentence. I interpret this to mean that the district sets forth and communicates expectations for acceptable and appropriate use of technology by staff and students. And that is an umbrella that just encompasses a multitude of things that's all tied up in one neat sentence. So I think that's great.
Additional comments?
For number 3, I don't know if this fits in board work or interpretation work, or like one drives the other, but this is where it seems like this is, if the board is going to take a stand on the importance of AI, that this is where it could fit, or alternatively, it could be specifically called out in a superintendent interpretation of. But I do think it's important that we call that out and as something that we see as a positive and a net positive. We know there's lots of limitations that we have, or education we have to put around it. And I think maybe that could be more explicitly expressed as well in this, but this may be board work for us to look at this to say where does AI integration and safeguards, because they need to go hand in hand, fit into our sort of thought and policies and procedures, because I think that we do need to call it out from here. Mm. Otherwise, it could potentially be.
Yeah, I can see calling. We probably need to be board work to look at the policy, because number 3 is specifically about courses.
Right.
And somehow the whole notion of the use of AI would be all encompassing and not just in technologically rigorous courses, right? Could be used in anything. But you're right, to finding a place for it.
And I guess I'm more thinking, you know, whereas computer science would be, that would have been the push 20 years ago. Now it'd be like, hey, we want to see specific courses on AI prompt.
Well, like generation, work. Right. Well, there's both things that specifically drive the use of the AI and just the overarching, the integration of AI and its use and expectations for both students and staff around AI.
Right. And I think that would come in our curriculum. Okay. One is what I would say. So I agree.
Yeah.
For me, it's both. It would be here specifically calling out that in the technology coursework, as well as then right. In our general comprehensive, where does it fit into our curriculum EL?
Yeah. For number 3, the where I was getting thinking back to it is this notion of, and I do want it, so advanced technologically rigorous courses, but we're talking about these pathways for our students to potentially, you know, there's a lot of talk of certifications in whether it's the Microsoft or the Google suite or Cisco or whatever type things. I just don't want to have those things be lost because somehow they're not deemed technologically rigorous enough. Right. Where so much of this might have been around like the AP computer science. Right. Not that. Right. So
I was going to say, you're getting to the point I wanted to make. So okay. Wait, sorry.
No, just broad enough that we're not just trying to pick off and ensure we have the very top rigorous courses, but a breadth of courses that would meet students' needs as they, you know, look at potential career paths and other types of either certifications or, you know, engagement with courses that are different.
And so the one for me, and I keep looking at number 1 to see if what I'm about to say was there, the equitable access, but it kind of gets to your point. And like, I think we could get very excited about some of these emerging technologies. I think we have a real sort of here and now, maybe 3 to 5 years ago opportunity, which is there's a lot that we own and hold today that can be providing supports in special services, as an example, or other supports for students. Now that we have one-to-one devices, that's a topic I still want to make sure we're staying with, which isn't, I don't mean to say, right, getting distracted by a specific, advanced AI model, but we have tools in kids' hands today that are not being maximized to help with their learning experience. So the ability to have spoken text, does every student know that? The ability to have other tools that assist reading, or the ability for visually disabled people like myself, like, are we using those tools day to day and supporting the access to learning for our students? Yes, there's stuff that's next generation, which is great. And I'm really excited how much we've talked about it tonight, because it makes me feel like my world is here. But I think that there's a lot in it. And for me, it's in this one, which is equitable access to, and it's not so much, I mean, equitable access to the technology is one piece, but are we leveraging the technology to have equitable access to learning in the most elegant way? And that's where I think we have a gap, and where I'd like to see represented a little differently.
And that's where I think some of the evidence could be that assistive technology, right? Mm-hmm. So how is assistive technology being implemented so all students can access learning? I think for me, and why three just is bothersome, is it just doesn't provide the detail that, and I think this is board work, of when I look at the interpretation, their interpretation to me seems to be so focused on high school, but we really need this to push into late elementary. And but I mean, I'm not saying that you interpret it wrong. I'm saying you interpret it as written. And this is why it's probably board work to be more expansive, because it really is, you know, you touch on it a little bit by supporting student interests, but we really see a need for that to change early in middle school years. And, you know, it wasn't that many years ago we got rid of TechSmart. It's still a pretty recent thing that used to be a sixth grade requirement, mm-hmm. because we want, again, more choice. But so somehow I just feel like it's just not really meeting the where we are today, especially with one-to-one. Mm-hmm. And then the other one is number five. I think because of one-to-one, I think the simplicity misses the point about reliable. And reliability is really, really important in the era of one-to-one. And so whether that's in the interpretation versus in evidence, but reliability is critical now that we've moved to one-to-one. And that's where we've seen a lot of hiccups across all of our high school campuses, at least, about that reliability piece. And so that's going to be an essential part. And so I don't know if it needs to be called out in the evidence, in the interpretation versus evidence. I don't really care, but that's a missing piece currently.
Director Meraldo?
I guess just a few comments to me is around, when we've been talking about artificial intelligence, however that is, I think that's going to really land on what is the equitable access to that technology. If one student can be paying Khan Academy $20 a month and get a robust system, and somebody else is using ChatGPT, those are two very different applications. One's free, one's not. So what are we going to do to allow students to have access to something that's robust? And, so that may be something where we end up in some type of agreement with a corporation of some type to say, you know, what are you providing? And can we provide that for all students so that they're not paying for it? So I think that there's going to be some discussions around that and where that lands. I agree that I do feel like what's available in around courses, I do think needs to go much earlier, because there always has been historically in the evidence a focus on the past. And I absolutely agree with Director Moore in that we've got to be looking at those certifications. Those are robust. Those are rigorous. You're ending up with a certification that people, that adults go through to use in their career. So I think that really looking at what are we making available? And I think that's what's missing is how do we want to talk about, career and technical ed. It's called technical ed for a reason, where students are actually able to leave our system with the ability of a living wage job. And it's going to be around technology in most areas in a lot of those cases. So how do we incorporate that's part of that desire? And so I do think that maybe some board discussion at some point around this the CEL to really say, is it robust enough for us?
Yep, I've noted that in the upcoming topics for us. So I've got that down. Any additional feedback or commentary? Nope. Superintendent, do you feel like you have what you need on that feedback?
Yes, I do. Thank you.
And then we have one more.
Three of three. So I'm just going to,
civic engagement. Let's keep going.
Work of the plan here. So for ends three, civic engagement, there are a couple of, there were just some obvious changes. Like I removed a ton of information about COVID. And that felt like, that's part of the cleanup as part of we've been going through this whole year. And I do want to acknowledge that there were, from what I saw from the last conversation, actually in April, almost exactly a year ago, I think was the ends three conversation, if I'm not misremembering, the conversation really around some of the survey data and specific questions that highlight some of the big areas of interest and concern for the board around social media. How our students are feeling about their engagement with each other through internet use or other social media venues, some themes around the impact of screen time, and then really what does reasonable progress mean for secondary and needing more work potentially on understanding that and the evidence and how we're approaching high school in particular. So those are some themes I heard that sort of live in the evidence, but I wanted to sort of share that I was looking at this through that lens of that conversation last. And those are the main things I would just highlight. And again, as I look through the interpretations, trying to also focus on cleaning up, language, modernizing language as needed, thinking about our equity commitment to our students and to our community, given that we have such a diverse community of people with lots of different cultures and lots of different strengths and assets overall. So those are the ways I approach this interpretation.
Wonderful. Thank you. Again, I will make a call for public comment. And on Zoom as well. Any new thoughts? Anything else you wanted to share, Jordan? Just I want to make sure you can jump in if you would like. Okay, thank you. Then we'll go and have some board discussion on this one.
I really like the interpretation on 3.1. It's very different from what we had before in a good way.
I was an American government major.
There we go.
I was excited to write this one, and I also enlisted the partnership pretty heavily with Executive Director of Equity and Family Partnership, Elena Sivadasan. So that was a fun conversation for me.
Okay. That maybe that shows, because most of them really shrank, right? This one was a little more expansive. It's all good, but that might tell why.
I didn't really think about that until just now, so I had to verbally share that with you all.
No, but I think it's an important thing to have in the interpretation because there's a lot of political pressure on redefining what history means. So I like that it's laid out this way.
For 3.5, after the word social media, I would strike the word on others, because we really want it to be on themselves and others. So, but that's encapsulated by so that they can protect themselves and others, that follows. But otherwise, I feel like that says we only want them to understand the misuse and impact of technology and social media on others, but it's really about how it impacts them. Mm-hmm. So I think you just strike the word on others, and that would be then inclusive of what our intent is.
Yep, that makes sense.
Director Maraldo?
No, I think that they're really great. You know, I was wondering at the beginning around the 3.1 and the amount of detail, but it does, it provides a great outline of how the evidence will then come to us, what different areas, and you'll be able to talk about it. So, no, I appreciate the interpretation.
Any additional thoughts or feedback?
Just sticking on the 3.5, because it's the last bullet's eliminated, but because you weren't here for this, and this was a really important addition that we did 7-ish years ago, it really is, what is that impact? And this is back to the student well-being part, and really want to highlight that. So that it really is about the impact of technology and social media that impacts a student's well-being and the well-being of their fellow students. So I feel like that part is missed. So if it's captured in the evidence, then great. But by streamlining the language, it carves out, I think, the most important parts. Because it's not about utilization based on ethical use. It's not about technology or about making positive contributions as much as it is about so that they are well from the impact of student on students' social, emotional, and mental health. So that is actually the intent of this bullet point.
Thank you. Yes. And sometimes the consolidation, some things get missed. So I appreciate that being brought forward. That actually tracks with my comments earlier about how I saw the connection between some of the comments earlier, or in the earlier last year's discussion around how students feel. So that actually tracks with that net. Thank you.
Yeah, that's right. Because I do remember that we added that bullet point 7 years ago. That long ago?
That was like one of my first things that I wanted to focus on was the mental health part, right?
It all blends together. I do want to just say, I'm going a little bit off track, but I did want to propose a change to ENDS 3. So maybe if I can get on a future agenda to do that, when we talked about the vision and I said I wanted something about integrity and compassion, and Harlan's suggestion was it belonged in ENDS 3. So at your convenience, I would like to do a proposed first read, second read.
I have added it to my potential upcoming topic
list. Since we're talking about ENDS 3 now, I thought I'd bring it up.
Thank you.
I did also want to make a positive comment around number 3.7. When you talk about that students will have an opportunity to reflect on their actions and choices when unintended consequences, et cetera. And I think that that really speaks to a restorative justice mindset that has not been presented as evidence to us before. So I really appreciated that in the interpretation.
Yeah, I noticed that as well and liked it.
Any additional comments or feedback or thoughts? Superintendent, is that enough information for you to move forward?
Yes, this is very helpful. So thank you.
Thank you very much for going through all three of those. That brings us to our next section on legislative matters. Director Gallinger.
Luckily, we had our chief financial officer go through much of it. So the two things that I'll highlight is, one, thank you to this board for your support of the engagement that we have continued to do. And I think every little bit helps. And the fact that we're able to do our part to push across that really important legislation with the increase in the multiplier that was in 5311 is what was approved in the conference budget is huge. Thank you for the support of us getting that letter off to Representative Bergquist. And like I said, every little bit counted to get that funding bill across. I wanted to highlight that transitional K, just so you understand the subtle difference, what that really was to do is in statute to clearly call out that it is not part of basic education. So therefore, its funding will always be at a whim because it's not part of basic education, which is part of the constitutional mandate. So from a planning and contracting standpoint, we have to bear that in mind that those are not protected contracts necessarily. And I don't know how that impacts from as you build contracts in things that aren't necessarily protected. I'm sure all of our 7-period day, that's also not obviously that's something above and beyond, but that could be something on a given year if the funding on that were to dry up because the whim of the legislature would be to, hey, we're going to no longer fund this because this is outside of basic education. We're going to do this priority instead, like homelessness, as an example, then that would be gone. And we would have to then decide, is that going to be levy dollars that fund that or not? And so what I worry is that this is where they, because the legislature is a bit frustrated that this happened. And yet they want to promote that K-12 can be innovative. And yet when K-12 is innovative, we get our hand slapped, even though this demonstrates really outsized impact to kids. Like across the state, if you remember what I shared earlier from what Reichdahl spoke on, like this small token amount of money delivers 40% growth in these children. So, but I worry that they're going to be like, oh, look, it's going to be a district like want, not a district need. So just FYI, I wanted to highlight to the board so that there's not a surprise if the administration brings like next year, like, look at here, this is now been zero. This account is zeroed out. Because for us, because of this, we grew our program from 12-ish students to 40-ish students. And so that's three teachers. So other than that, I think that we can all express gratitude to Senator Wellman. And I did that today as well in conversation with her for really just being a champion on special education funding. And she went into the session saying that that was what she was going to do. When we met with her on our day on the Hill, she committed to that and just super excited that she was able to negotiate that through. So, and our next step for us as now that session is over will be to again, get our spring visits into our buildings with legislators. So I think in particular, it would be great for some of them. So we'll focus on Holly Street for our spring ones because it's so far done. And for them to see that preschool space that is going to be built and developed, I think it will be really important for them, especially since Senator Mollett is a key architect of the capital budget, as is Representative Callan. So as we look for where we'll build our spring ones, I think Holly Street will be an important one, as well as taking Senator Wellman through Cedar Trails for the inclusive practices that happen there, because that's an important thing for her. So,
wasn't Representative Callan at the ribbon cutting for Holly Street? I kind of remember that
she was invited. I'm not sure she actually made it.
I could misremember.
Oh, yeah, no, she was there, but Reference Sem was also invited, and we thought we were going to be there because I think that our superintendent had scheduled meeting at the same time there or that day or something to follow in the tour.
We toured Representative Sen and Representative Callan as well. I believe it was not the same day.
Not the same day. Okay.
It was a separate visit to continue to support that exposure to where we are in progress of that site.
Yes. So look ahead to hearing from me about those dates. And that's it.
Thank you. And I also want to say a big thank you to you, Director Gallinger, for all of the effort you've put in into not just organizing our perspective on what we need in special education, but organizing directors across the area. And it's just very impressive to see that collective push toward really doing, getting a great outcome for our students. So thank you. Excuse me. Our next section is announcements and correspondence. They are included in the agenda that went out. Are there any additional items that we need to make note of? Okay. We thank you. So we will move on to calendaring and future agenda topics. I have a couple. One is that first is solidifying our board graduation speaker slots, or our acceptance slots for this year's graduations. This is the list as I've written it down. Hopefully I've gotten it right. So what I have listed would be Director Gallinger for Liberty, Director Moore for Issaquah, Director Meraldo for Gibson Eck, and Director Weaver for Skyline. Did I write that down or need any changes in that order? I think I got everybody to their choice.
It is just an acceptance, right?
It is purely an acceptance. Yeah. There is no additional speech this year. Okay. I have confirmed that.
Okay, thank you.
So we have that noted, so we can start that communication of who will be, and I will be a glorious participant in watching you guys work. Thank you for your service. The next item I have is for discussion is a need to update the second board meeting in May. And I guess I'll probably need a motion for this. We'll see what happens. Because of scheduling conflicts, and would like to take all the appropriate steps to get that currently scheduled at May 24th board meeting moved and scheduled to May 23rd.
Which we all have available because we all have another meeting scheduled on May 23rd.
That's correct. All right. Want a motion? So do we need a motion, I think?
You do it.
Okay. I move the board meeting scheduled for May 23rd be moved to May 24th. Other way around.
May 24th to the 23rd.
Reverse what I said. Move the May 24th meeting to May 23rd. Sorry.
Second.
Do we have any discussion on this topic or any concerns about that move? Yes. No, I thought you were unmuting. Apologies. No. Director Meraldo, any concerns with that one?
No.
Okay. Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
That leaves us with one additional change. This is when we can start and potentially finish. Through maybe a poll or something later if we can't get there. First of all, really appreciate your flexibility on making that change. I realize I'm the driver of this needed adjustment, and so I appreciate that support. So the rescheduling of the second meeting of the board and exec session for the superintendent yearly annual evaluation, that was at the moment scheduled on May 23rd, we would need to find a new date. I would like to offer three dates to see if they might work. They are June 9, June 12, or June 16.
office needs good things.
Oh, she probably would love that.
I can do any of those days.
I can do any of those days.
We'll have cake if we do it on your birthday.
Okay, I'll be there for that.
I can do any of those 3 days.
Uh-oh. Dang. Come on. I definitely can't do the 12.
Okay.
Okay.
We hate that one then. We don't need it.
Definitely don't want to do the 16th.
Come on with the 9th.
I really don't want to do the 9th, but I guess I would be willing to do the 9th. I mean, more importantly, I worry about we're getting kind of late in
yes.
our cycle. I even worry is the 9th.
Yeah, the 16th would be late.
Yes.
Is the 9th too late? Because our board meeting is on the 8th, and I thought the 8th was when we generally have that conversation.
We could do it on the 22nd.
Yeah. Because the 22nd is usually the contract conversation. So I thought we didn't do them both on the same time.
We have.
I know we have.
Oh.
But I don't. Yeah. So I guess the other way is what we could do is if we did it on the 9th, that we could have carve out time during. Oh, no, that's after. No, when do graduations? Graduations.
The 5th. Graduation. Big graduations day is the 15th.
So then we could maybe carve out time on the 15th to do an executive session, to have that conversation, to review things, which we've done in the past as well. And then just have the contract conversation on the 22nd.
So I suggest we take it one step at a time.
Hmm.
But I hear your suggestion about the additional 2 conversations, and I'll note those.
And I assume there was a reason that we couldn't bump earlier into June. Is somebody gone?
Well, the only date he offered up, I couldn't do.
I think.
Oh, okay. So the second.
We had May 31st. Like
that, out of was the question.
The May... earliest I could do is the 7th.
Yes. Oh, okay.
Oh, that's early because you're gone from a big chunk. Must be from the end of May through.
Yep, the end. I've got something from the end of May.
Got it.
I have theater tickets on the 7th, but I could move them if I had to.
We won't have Director Moore back on the 7th.
No, I'd be here on the 7th. It wasn't my favorite. I texted you dates and.
Yes.
Yeah, so it was my. Oh yeah, it was my least favorite, but.
That's like all the Fridays that have been offered to us.
Well, actually, the 7th doesn't really buy us anything somebody would have to go home at 10 o'clock and draft the thing for the meeting the next day. So,
which I don't mind. I mean, my goal would be to come into the second meeting.
I think that sounds painful. Yeah, I agree.
That's painful.
Okay. I was offering that
because we want to have time to review it anyway.
Oh, fair.
Yeah, that's true.
It usually does take a cycle.
Not that we don't trust you.
No, that's fair. I was just saying I'm willing.
Yeah.
The seventh doesn't work.
Okay.
So we're back to the 9th.
Back to the 9th.
How early could we do it? Maybe that's how I could be willing.
Oh.
You could sell me on it early.
Oh, you mean earlier than 6 or?
Yeah, I mean, so.
On the 9th, I free up at 1 p.m.
Like high school schedule joy.
Mm-hmm.
So Friday after school is one of the few moments where you actually can be a family.
And whatever time.
So. I free up as early as
well. When, I am free on the 9th.
Yeah, Marnie?
Then let's do one.
I free up by about noon.
You want to do one? Is that what you
mean? Mine was my limitation will be 1
right.
Mm-hmm, that day, but I can start at 1.
I could start at 1.
Ooh, that was elegant. Thank you, Director Gallinger. Okay, so 1 p.m. June 9th. Can I have a motion?
Okay. I move that the exec session for the evaluation of the superintendent, which was originally scheduled for Tuesday, May 23rd, be moved to Friday, June 9th, beginning at 1 p.m., 1:30?
1 p.m.
1 p.m. Still at my house, still probably 3 hours. That's it.
I was trying to write it in my calendar. Second.
Motion.
Thank you both for that. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Bye.
Thank you. Okay. Oh, wow.
Okay. And so those are my last.
Those are my last items. We'll come back and sort out the final two.
Oh,
go ahead.
Did you have other items?
I do not. I was going to say I do not have. Okay.
I have an item. I wanted to. Oh, what?
He also has one.
Oh, you also have one. I wanted to indicate that as we had said we would do, Director Weaver and I updated the school board handbook, and it has been posted to the website. And I mention this because we would like this recorded in the minutes explicitly, because it's in our policy that we do this. And so this is our mechanism to indicate that. I know
that we did it.
I know Director Gallinger and I had a conversation just about the fact that we were updating this handbook and does the board need to approve it? And I went back and looked, and we have not technically approved it as a board before. If you wanted something like that, then we could put it into policy and potentially do it. But at this point, all we've done is indicate that it's been updated in the minutes. Okay. So that's that one.
And I can also mention that it's been posted on the website.
And it's on the website. Yeah. Yep.
Yes. Thank you. And we sold it to the people.
We did.
Sold is the wrong word, but we pushed it out to all the people who attended the candidate information center session. Wow. I can't talk after 9:30 on, was that Monday? That was Monday.
Monday. That. Yes.
Monday. Yes. This week.
We've been busy.
Thank you for that update. And thank you for hosting that session. Director Gallinger.
I have an agenda topic I would like us to consider adding for a future meeting. So I think we've heard enough about the challenges of the Issaquah High School Stadium project, and I appreciate the update that our superintendent gave. I think there should probably be some formal board dialogue on saying we need to prioritize funding this track project and this lighting project. And in the ways that we have had to prioritize projects in the past or move things around. And so there may be, in just like how the Issaquah Stadium project got moved and delayed, there may be where we want to intentionally call out and say some voter approved capital levy projects in our 4-year levy that we just approved last year were initially part of it. But we believe that from a safety and student well-being standpoint, we are going to prioritize and do this now, and that we are formally saying this so that isn't then down the road, well, you never said this, you guys bait and switched, why didn't this project that was listed to be done in 2026 not get done? And so I think we just need to formally have this dialogue and conversation and formally say, like, this is an important, like, go forth and do, we want new lights at Issaquah as soon as feasible. Because certainly now that we are made well aware of this, I believe that the risk of their student harm based on any sort of injury on the field. And again, I've been on and been and watched as a spectator on the field, and they are absolutely valid in that the differences between at least Skyline and Issaquah are pretty dramatic from a lighting and safety, player safety standpoint. So I believe that the lights and the track. And then to also specifically call out and remind people that the limitation of any sort of bleacher replacement because of the city calculations, I mean, like, to put that to bed, say, like, we will not be doing that. We can't do that short of building a parking garage, which is the last thing we want to do. But I would like to prioritize that because I think we also want to model that listening part. The community has spoken and said, hey, this is really a safety issue. This is an equity issue. This is a follow through on what you said you would do in 2012, I guess it was. So
thank you for that addition.
Just to add to that, I don't know what the rules are around whether or not we would have to approve a restating of repurposing of those funds. So I think that would be part of that.
Thank you for that. Just trying to write down in my notes. Okay. Any other items? Okay. If not, we are officially adjourned.